Good evening, everyone. Welcome you to the regularly scheduled May meeting of the Southampton Village Planning Board. If everybody could silence their cell phones to avoid interruption, that'd be great. If I could have a motion to open the meeting, I'd appreciate it.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
First item on the agenda, Beechwood Latch actually requires 30 days from notification of all other potential boards who might have an interest in this application for this board to become the lead agent. That time period has not passed yet, and therefore the Beechwood Latch application remains adjourned until this board becomes the lead agency. We've slightly modified the agenda for this evening as well to move up the Southampton Village ambulance application, which was discussed at the previous meeting of 185 Windmill Lane. There's a lot line modification and site plan review for this application still pending, and remains to the application remains open for public comment. So I'd like to invite at this point interested members of the public to address the board regarding this application.
Roy, if I might interject, this has been on the cusp of a decision now for at least one meeting. It's been my knowledge through direct communications with counsel for one of the nearby property owners that his client wishes to have further consideration by the board made. So I would suggest the most expedient way to do this would be to ask Mr. Borovina if he would like to address the board and sort of define or outline what the position of his client is.
Thank you, Mr. Ron. Is that fair? Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Mr. Robinson. My name is Anton Borovina, and I represent two of the neighbors, Michael Jeanke and Joseph Becquois, who own 205B Windmill Lane and 215 Windmill Lane. They are immediately adjacent to the proposed site. And there are several things I'd like to include as part of this public comment. And as I do this, I would like to distribute a we have retained an environmentalist engineer with his qualifications are listed in the report I'm about to give you that identifies the specifically the incomplete or inaccurate nature of the environmental assessment form. It's his opinion, as it is mine, that the EAF that is currently before the board is insufficient for purposes of enabling the board to determine a declaration of non-significance. By the way, before I even get to that, let me just say I certainly understand. I read the commentary regarding the jurisdiction. It is my opinion as well. I believe that the board has jurisdiction under the village code, notwithstanding the fact that the property itself is owned by the trustees. As the lead agency under CEQA, the CEQA statute, of which you now speak for, in connection with all involved or interested agencies, requires this board, this planning board, at the earliest opportunity, and not when the project starts, but at the earliest opportunity, to identify all areas of environmental concern and to take a hard look at the environmental concern for purposes of deciding whether or not a declaration of significance or non-significance could be given. Of course, and as I stated earlier, we believe that insufficient consideration, insufficient hard look has been given with respect to the application now before the board. That said, I would like to take this opportunity, and with the chairman's permission, I would like to take this opportunity now to give, I believe we need 7 copies of the report to be included as part of the file. Who do I?
You have to go to the right.
Yep. Want 7 copies?
I
I'd like to summarize the discrete issues were based upon my review and the consultant's review, Dr. Padone, an environmentalist trained engineer who teaches on the subject, opinion that the EAF currently before the board is inadequate. Right off the get-go, we all noticed, and I noticed, that the village itself describes the lot in play as a park. Now the park, there's no existing structures there. It is moms and dads and children, as well as apparently even pets, use the facility for recreational purposes. It is centrally located within the village for that purpose. There's no other complementary adjoining parcel similarly capable of being used that would service the residents of the village vis-a-vis the center of where the village is. So it's a park, and the question is whether or not a hard look has been made with respect to its identification as a park, and the answer is no. The EAF really doesn't address that issue at all. It doesn't talk about the recreational uses that are currently existing and how the recreational uses will be adversely impacted as a result of siting an ambulance facility on that lot and severely impacting and frankly precluding in large measure the ability of the lot to be used for recreational purposes. Now there are other areas.
And excuse me, I don't mean to interrupt
you,
but you said earlier that your clients were the immediately adjacent owners and now the issue of the park. I don't want to interrupt that, but are you aware of the fact that there are two parcels involved?
Yes, I am.
So there is a distinction between what we call the Lowell Apprentice Park and the site where the building is going to be built.
And that's correct. But and by the way, thank you, Mr. Robinson, that's correct. But I think it's fair to say everyone would know that the two lots, when you look at them, when mom and pop walk down and are now perusing through the park, are not differentiating between one park and the other. It's lawn. It's unused. It's meant for recreational purposes. There are no existing facilities. You can't compare. The area has not been previously impacted by either a residential, commercial, or industrial use. That would therefore, one can conclude, given its existing use, enable with minimal leap of faith to go to an ambulance facility. But that's exactly what's happened here. We have parkland jumping from that to a commercial use, frankly. That is the use of an ambulance facility, which will generate a bunch of other issues. I'll get to this later in my presentation. But have an effect environmental values. And those environmental values have to be examined by this board for purposes of deciding whether or not a declaration should be given. And frankly, therefore, what is the record before this board that enables the board to do this if it's going to decide today, as opposed to, frankly, not deciding a resolution today, waiting until the required hard look and a response is given, in particular, to the report that was given to you today, to the chairman and to the members of the board. Let me go on, if I can. Let me just summarize some of the more salient ones. For example, there's a reference, the EAF doesn't take into account subdivision D2D, which talks about whether or not waste will be generated. Not only is an ambulance facility going up in this site, but as Mr. Dunn and others have noted, Ron Hill has noted, there's going to be increased activity associated with the site. There are going to be membership meetings. A lot of automobiles are going to be using it. As I understand it, looking at the site plans, there's going to be a gym. There's going to be other facilities that will be attractive to others to come into the facility and therefore create more stress on the use of the facility and the abutting land. That has not been taken into account by the board with respect to whether or not there is a substantial likelihood or substantial increase in the generation of waste. The same thing is, let's talk about traffic. I am mindful of the fact that, and as you are, of course, that Windmill Lane is a congested lane. We know this. But there is a difference between an ambulance that is perusing down Windmill Lane, which originated from someplace else, going through Windmill Lane to get to service of the other areas and the fine job that they do, and we all know that. There's a difference between that versus the ambulance originating right where the police station is, you know the area, and now with the ambulance, you and I are in our ambulance, we're now leaving the lane to get into Windmill Lane, which as you know, in June, July, August, and September, is wall-to-wall cars. That's the way it is. And so the ambulance has to now bully its way into that lane for purposes of either going left or right. In addition to the sirens will be going on, there's no question about it, it'll be going on much more frequently than if the, than where the ambulance facility is currently located, and the kinds of traffic ingress and egress associated with ambulances leaving the facility from its current location. So as a result, there is inadequate assessment with respect to traffic. May I say, based upon my read of the traffic study, by the way, I certainly am familiar with Ron Hill, he's a fine traffic engineer. That said, I note that this traffic study was done in March. Frankly, it doesn't even consist of a traffic study. I know what Mr. Hill is capable of doing, and I've seen him do other kinds of traffic studies. This is not one of them. The traffic study in place simply calls into the fact that, well, we've done it in March. We understand that there's going to be a heavy season in, and you know this, in June, July, August, and September. We know what the ambulance use was in its prior place. Okay, well, that's a matter of public record. The question is, what is going to be the impact on traffic with respect to a new location, which is now centrally located and unlike its prior existing location? Before I submit, before you can adopt a neg deck resolution, you really have to take a hard look at traffic. And how do you do that? You do that, first of all, as CEQA requires, at the earliest possible moment, not as the project is going up. That's number one. Number two, you really do that, by the way, when a traffic study is completed during the peak season. It does us no good, I respectfully submit, that you have a traffic study in this town. The rule may be different in other places in Suffolk County or in Nassau, but you don't have a situation in the village where you have a traffic study in March when we all know that the intensity of use is June, July, and actually the summer months. That's when you really sit back and study this. And the impact or the associated impacts is frankly beyond this board to really assess until it has proper assessment. Now, let me give you an example. It may very well be that as a result of the increased traffic generation at Windmill Lane, there could be a requirement as an appropriate mitigation measure to put various, not just lighting or more sophisticated lighting systems, but also sophisticated lanes and also the restructure of curb cuts going in and out of the existing facility where the parking lot currently is. That's going to affect a number of things. It's going to affect, by the way, how the property is currently configured. It's going to affect, it may have an impact on how the building is ultimately constructed to take into account the potential adverse impact associated with ambulances leaving the lot going onto Windmill Lane. My point is, and I'm just a lawyer, that no one in this room is, in the absence of this traffic study, able to adequately assess the impact associated with traffic without a traffic study. And that's another significant point I'd like the board to consider. The next one is likewise, it's a corollary to what I said earlier about the intensity of use, the use of herb energy and herbicides. I refer, by the way, to D2Q, K, Q, and R of the environmental assessment form. Now, I know that the EAF really talks about commercial or industrial use. Now, this is, I submit, well, it's not an industrial use, but it's a commercial use. Granted, the owner of the property happens to be the village, but that doesn't disqualify it or immunize it from the consequences of CEQA compliance. And its ambulance use under CEQA necessarily has to be looked at that purpose. The environment could give a flying hoot, I respectfully submit, whether or not the government is the one who owns the facility in its proprietary capacity. Nevertheless, it is an ambulance use that ought to be considered as such and considered in terms of what environmental impacts are associated with it. That would mean, therefore, that impact on energy, impact on herbicides, where there's currently a park, but now you're going to have insecticides, herbicides, you're going to have other things associated with the proper maintenance of this ambulance facility, as well as the use of water and wastewater. One other consideration mentioned by Dr. Padone is the issue of noise. I am also mindful that sirens are barreling down Windmill Lane. As ambulances barrel down Windmill Lane, the sirens on occasion go on. I know that. There's nothing we can do about that. But there is a difference, I submit, for which there's not been an adequate study. Whether or not an ambulance originates from the area versus simply traveling through the area. An ambulance that originates from the air necessarily will be making noise. And it would make noise in a way that has not been adequately discussed at all in the environmental impact statement. By the way, a note in passing that there is a dog, pet dogs. Now, I'm quite sure the pet owners could give a flying hoot whether or not there's an ambulance there. But I do think that the dogs, however, are going to mind when they hear the noise. They're going to make the associated noise generated by the generation of sirens from the ambulance facility. That does not exist right now because of ambulances simply going back and forth on Windmill Lane. But it would exist by virtue of the ambulances originating from the ambulance facility. By the way, I noticed that there are several aspects of the EAF which is simply not answered at all. For example, on impact on land, I refer to part two, question one. The answer is yes. The Nelson and Pope says yes, it has an impact, but nothing else is checked. There's no assessment is given with respect to question number one. With respect to question number four, also yes, there's going to be apparently an impact on groundwater. There's no assessment. None of the boxes in EAF are actually checked. I'm not able. Now my client is not able, and I say this record is not able to adequately determine the associated impacts of groundwater and on impact on land when you have the answer yes to the question, but there's simply no evaluation whatsoever. I call that the absence of a hard look. Likewise, with respect to open space and recreation, I talked about that earlier. I refer, by the way, to question 11, recreational purposes. It is recognized as such, but no consideration of its status as recreational purposes given. I understand, by the way, that the lots are adjacent to historical or within historical sites. There's no reference to its impact on historical sites given its current use, which frankly is vacant, and now would have an intensification of use associated with being used as an ambulance facility. But is it consistent with community plans? Well, I think that certainly it's not been a hard look at that at all. Right now, the community looks at that lot, and in response again to Mr. Robinson's very pointed question, they look at this as a park, to be used as a park. That's the community plan. And there's going to be an abrupt change from that plan into more of an intensification of use, which is going to be happening several times a day as ambulances both enter and leave the facility. By the way, I noticed in part three when, you know, reasons why the question is asked, give you reasons why the neg deck should be issued, and the assessment, it's a one-liner that says in the EAF, well, we don't think there's any adverse environmental impacts being raised, but that sort of begs the question. The writer concludes that report, that inserts that sentence in, because they, based upon what their earlier representations, and I just mentioned to you, and as Dr. Padone corroborates, that there are many issues in the EAF that have not been properly identified. I note one other thing too, by the way, and with respect to for example, I'm aware of, and it's called an EAF mapper. It's a public record on this. The public record is used by the industry and is used for lots, and it confirms, for example, if a lot is next to an agricultural district. Is it next to an historical archaeological district, or is it next to an archaeological site? According to the EAF mapper, a public record, it identifies that the lots are next to the Cooper Captain Mercantile House, which is a place of archaeological and historical significance, and it's called the Cooper Captain Mercantile House, let me just say, by the way, I'm mindful that the Historical Society, a potential lead agency, declined to act as lead agency. That's fine, but it does not alleviate this board's obligation as the responsible lead agency to take into account these kinds of things in the public statements, which include, by the way, the EAF map. There's no reference to any of the Historical Society. The proximity of the land to an historic district, which has not been taken into account at all. I think that really summarizes it. If there's any questions that the board has that concerning this, it is our position that the record before this board is inadequate for purposes of enabling it to determine that a required hard look has been taken for purposes of issuing your neg deck. We are here today. The public hearing, by the way, is in connection with your decision to neg, should you issue a declaration of positive or negative significance. What I'm saying is you don't have enough information to do that now, and to do so now is actually premature in the absence of a further study. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Conrad, could you just, oh, I thought you were coming to speak. Sorry. No, you're leaving. Sign out. Ms. Heidman, Kathy, I'm sure you want to address many of the points council made regarding the document that Nelson Pope prepared, but I don't know, having just seen it 2 minutes ago, that you're prepared to do that
at this point.
I would prefer not to.
I mean, there are a lot of things that were brought up that I'm surprised. I went through it, and I thought all of that was in there. You know, but we did recognize that it's in a historic district and dealt with many of the issues. There are many, some of the questions were unanswered because they did not apply. It's an institutional project, so technically they don't apply. If you want us to go back and answer how much herbicides might be used or how much, what was the other thing? Water generation? I can't remember, sorry.
Septic generation, increased septic generation.
Disposal of solid waste, there will be no disposal of solid waste on the site, but there will be obviously solid waste generated by the use. So, I mean, we could add those. I don't know that that would make this a positive declaration. That's where, you know, we're leading here. As far as the part two, there is a column that is, you know, it's hard to explain, but it used to be that you would answer one and then you would check off where the relevant impact was, and now it is no or small impact. So really, each one of those should have been no, where it's blank, unfortunately. So that would have to be corrected.
Well, I know I reviewed your report and the traffic study that was done quite thoroughly and in detail. The traffic study seems to me to not be aimed so much as to analyze how much traffic is on the street as to focus on how much additional traffic the presence of the ambulance center would provide, which came down to, I think, two or three, on average, three or four trips a day, and that was regarded in three trips a day as being not a huge increase to the amount of traffic that is on the road. So when you study how much is on the road, whether it's bumper to bumper or not, are three additional trips per day going to add that much? I think that was the main point of the traffic study, and also that the additional uses for meetings, whatever, tend to occur later at night or on weekends or at other days, so not to add again to the daily traffic on Windmill Lane. But again, these are all points that were raised in this letter. We've just received this shortly, so I think it's probably prudent to review these points in greater detail and respond to them. In the meantime, does anyone else in the public like to add their thoughts to this application?
I'd at least like to respond regarding the traffic. Ron Hill from Dunn Engineering, 66 Main Street, West Hampton Beach. We prepared the traffic study was done, and really the point was to show how little traffic we generate. It was more than two or three a day. It was, we said at the peak, when our facility generate, you know, they have a call, there's a couple of people maybe down there, we may generate up to a maximum of seven during the peak hours, during a weekday,
a.m. and p.m.
But we have lots of time when there's absolutely nothing going on. So if I took and looked at what the impact is on the intersections on Windmill Lane, primarily at North Sea Road or down at Nugent Street, and ran a calculation, there would be no change in level of service, no change in delay. we wouldn't be creating changes to the intersection, adding lanes. We wouldn't have to do any of that for what we're adding to those intersections. It gets down to like, once the traffic, if we're generating 7 and half goes north and half goes south, we're generating 4 going north. That's not going to change anything.
Excuse me, I have a question about the traffic study.
Roy. When Mr. Hill is done, you may address the board. Thank you.
Wait till he's done.
Wait till he's done, and then you can come up and speak.
It's part of what he's saying, too.
It doesn't, you're next. I have to have that in my thought.
Oh, sorry.
There was other discussion earlier about changes in traffic patterns. There's no change in traffic patterns if we do a signal time change. There is no change in traffic patterns if we do fire preemption at the, or emergency vehicle preemption at those signals. There's already that type of equipment in some signals in the village. Changing that doesn't constitute a change in traffic patterns. And in fact, the FHWA has recognized that when we do a public federally aid funded project, if we do signal timing changes, if we even change the signal, rebuild the signal, or add preemption, it's a negative deck automatically, because it's already recognized that that doesn't have an impact. I think that's all I have regarding traffic. It doesn't have to be done in season because there's so little traffic being generated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, my question is this. I'm hearing you talk about...
Could you say who you are?
I'm Eva Centeno, and I live on White Street.
Thank you.
And have lived on Cooper's Farm, so I know that neighborhood very well. I'm hearing that they're not going to generate more traffic, but how are they going to deal with the traffic that's there? They're EMS drivers. They're trying to get to an emergency. How do they do that when there is so much traffic on Windmill Lane? And where do the cars go when they need to get by? Because there's no room. And there'll be cars backed up, and there'll be cars coming the other way, and they may only be generating, from what I'm hearing, this traffic study, 4 cars, 7 cars, whatever. But what are they going to do to get through the traffic to the emergency that they're trying to get to? That's one question. Because if I needed an EMS, I'd want them to get through. And I don't think that they can easily get through on Windmill Lane. It's too narrow, it's too traffic, it's too busy. I can hardly get out from White Street half the time. So that worries me. It's just not enough space there. The other question I have is, has there been a study done on any of the noise level that's going to affect the homes that are there? That's a concern of mine. You know, I also have residents in New York City. There's a lot of noise when you are in a building of ambulances and fire engines and all those things. Has anybody done a study on the impact of the ambulances affecting Cooper's Farm and White Street homes? Those are my questions.
Are you aware where the ambulance facility is now?
No, that I'm not.
It's on the extension of Jobs Lane, Meeting House Lane, also a very busy road. Yeah, it's busy. The ambulance has got to go someplace. There's traffic in the summer here. I mean,
but I heard that there was a proposal, from what I read, that they go by the firehouse, the empty firehouse now, and that to me is a lot more spacious exit and entrance, and it's just more spacious. They can come and go, and they can go, you know, to the right or to the left a lot easier than that particular facility, from what I'm understanding.
It's on the same road. It's on Windmill Lane.
I understand, but it's further up, and there's more space up there.
If they need to go north, they're going to be heading the exact same way that the proposed structure would.
Except that they could go up that other road, I don't know the name of it, and go around. They don't have to be, there's that congested area is very congested. That's just my concerns. I'm throwing them out there. I don't know if there's been studies done. I don't know. From what I heard, from what I've read, that's what I'm asking.
Thank you.
Thank you for the time.
Can I say something? I'm the other half of this dynamic duo. I'm Greg Centeno. I live at 205 White Street. And This is a question to you, because I just heard about this, and it caused me to come and see and talk to all of you. Have other sites been evaluated?
Yes.
And has anybody considered putting this facility on the corner of Flying Point Road where the old...
At the first meeting where this project was discussed, the mayor, Mayor Epley, came in and discussed many of the other sites and why, for various reasons, this particular site was chosen. So yes, they have been presented to the board.
But my question is specifically, has anybody examined putting this facility in the old abandoned car dealership on the corner of...
I can't say that, because the point of this board is not to say where it should go. The point of this board is to deal with the application that it is presented with. So it's not up to us to look at all the other choices and say, well, it really should go someplace
right.
else.
So you know, I'm an architect and a planner. And, you know, to me, it's a no-brainer. In other words, you put it on that corner, you can go anywhere very quickly, right? And, you know, I understand it's not your land. But you have a lot of other land. Maybe you can give the guy land.
We are not the village. We are not the trustees. The trustees determined this application. It's presented to this board, and this board has to evaluate this application on its own merits. Mm-hmm. And that's what this board does. So whether it's not our purvey to decide that it really should go someplace else, it's whether or not this application meets the standards of the law.
Just okay. I got it.
There is a gentleman sitting in back of you, Mr. Stott, who is very knowledgeable of this, and maybe after the meeting you could check with him, and he'll be glad to inform you of the 7 or 8 or 9 years of study that went into the village arriving at the determination that this was the best spot for it.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Welcome.
Mr. Chairman, first I'd like to call up Chief Mike Camp for the fire department, who would like to explain how the firehouse is not unused on Windmill Lane.
Hi, my name is Mike Camp. I'm chief of the fire department. I wanted to speak on 2 points. One, what Ricky's asked me, and two, on something else that I heard tonight about the traffic study. One, Windmill Lane Firehouse by no means is unused. We have three of our pieces of apparatus in that firehouse. It's our rescue house, which stages our rescue truck, our rescue pumper, and our mini rescue truck, all which travel to every MVA, every house fire, every call we have. Two of our companies, our ladder company, meets there once a month. They drill there once a month. One of our hose companies meet there and drill there once a month. And our rescue squad meet there and drill there once a month. So the building is very much used by at least half of the fire department on a regular basis. Second, I'm not a lawyer, no Ron Hill in traffic studies, but for the past 8 years, I've been in the position of a chief of the fire department. I'm currently the chief, and I live on Jagger Lane. Windmill Lane has never been an issue for me. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Rick, you guys ran around 800 calls last year. We ran around 1,200. I use Windmill Lane every time I leave my house. And I know my first assistant chief lives on White Street, and same as him, he uses Windmill Lane every time he leaves his house. As far as I know, no dogs were upset at me. I'm not sure, but hard to tell. But the traffic doesn't seem to be an issue for us in just a Tahoe, not a fire truck, not an ambulance, just a Tahoe trying to get through traffic. So thank you. I just wanted to make sure we cleared that up.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Mike. I'm Rick Fowler. I'm chief of the Southampton Village Volunteer Ambulance. We are here tonight because there's been many misconceptions and false information provided to the board regarding the new ambulance headquarters, which we would like to clear up. The first point that I would like to bring up is that some say this vote and project were, quote unquote, underpublicized. Over the course of the last 7 years, this project in progress, or lack thereof, has been highly publicized. I would like to refer you to the packet of newspaper articles that was submitted at the work session. There were numerous newspaper articles that were published long before this vote took place. By doing a simple search on 27 East's website, you'll find lots and lots of articles covering this. A lot of these articles cover each time this project was discussed at the village trustee meetings. In addition to these newspaper articles, the ambulance volunteers hosted several open houses at the current facility, where members of the community were invited to attend to see the current issues, as well as offer ideas and suggestions about the new facility. Each one of these open houses and community informational meetings were advertised in the newspapers, through mailers, and it was even on local radio stations. As the vote was getting closer, plans were presented at these open houses, and the community was given chances to review and discuss the plans and location. Each one of these open houses were published in local newspapers as well. Additionally, the village trustees hired a public relations company to help publicize the entire project. There were mailers sent out prior to the vote to every village resident, copies of which were also submitted in the packets. These mailers included details about the project, including the location at which it was being proposed, the date, time, and place of the vote, outline of the project scope, as well as upcoming dates of public informational meetings regarding the proposed project. In addition to these mailers, there was also a video made about the project, which was posted online for about 3 years. As you can see, this project did not just pop up and get rushed through. Despite what some are claiming, this project was highly publicized over the last 7 years. Whether those that are claiming these allegations chose not to review any of the published material or attend the community informational meetings, this is out of our control, and we have made every effort to publicize this project. Clearly, 319 residents knew enough about this project in order to show up and cast their vote. This is a democracy, and it is very obvious that there was more yes votes than there were no votes, therefore approving this project. Just because this vote didn't go in the favor of some should not be grounds to demand a revote or grounds to change the project. Next, I'd like to mention that several other options were considered prior to selecting this location. One of our other members will speak about this shortly, but just to refer back to the packet, there is even a newspaper article with the headline, "Southampton Village Officials Look at Four Options for New Ambulance Headquarters." This current project and location was very well thought out prior to selecting the final location. Next, I would like to say that there are several assumptions that have been made, which seems to be a sticking point. For starters, the new headquarters will not be able to house 7 ambulances, as some have assumed. There are 5 apparatus bays, 2 of which are deeper than the others. This is to accommodate for our 3 ambulances, our beach and off-road rescue vehicle, which is used quite often throughout the year, and our advanced life support first responder vehicle, which the responder on duty uses. The reason 2 of the apparatus bays are deeper than the others are so we are able to put our chief vehicle first responders inside during inclement weather standbys. These deeper bays are not long enough to allow 2 ambulances to be kept in them. They are only long enough for 1 ambulance and 1 Tahoe vehicle front to back. The reason these other responders need to be inside during the inclement weather standbys is because the medications and supplies must remain climate controlled and also to protect the vehicle during hurricanes and snowstorms. By keeping the vehicles inside during this helps avoid to clean off the snow from the vehicle when there's a call, which causes delay. Another assumption which was made in regards to our fitness room. Southampton Village is required by law to supply the members with a fitness facility. Currently, the village has to pay for gym memberships at SYS, which is long out of our district. This means that when a volunteer is working out at SYS and there's a call, they now must drive from out of the district to our ambulance headquarters to answer a call, which causes delays. As a way to save the village taxpayer money, it was decided that we will put a fitness room in the new headquarters so the village would not have to pay for gym memberships anymore for our ambulance volunteers. Also, don't you think it is a benefit to have members using the fitness equipment inside the ambulance building rather than somewhere out of district? If there is a call when a member is using the fitness equipment, they will be already at headquarters and can jump right in the ambulance to answer the call, which decreases any delays. There's also been some mention about the energy demand and usage. And with that being said, our architect has designed a LEED status building, which will most likely receive a silver or gold status. This means that the energy usages have been well thought out, and equipment and processes have been planned to lower these usages. An example included in this project is solar panels on the roof, solar hot water heaters, as well as all Energy Star equipment and lighting, which is extremely efficient and will significantly decrease the cost to operate the facility. Even though it has been mentioned before, I would like to mention that the 72 additional parking spaces are not all for the ambulance members to use. These parking spaces are to fix an issue that is already going on at this location. The court was never anticipated to be part of the police station when that was designed, and therefore there's not enough parking for the court. Period. Again, in an effort to save the village taxpayers' money, it was decided that the extra court parking would be included in this project, so the ambulance parking lot would not get ruined when the court parking was added at a later date. Speaking of saving the taxpayers' money, by delaying this project will actually cost the taxpayers more money. We have been advised by the construction managers, who are very well versed in this matter, that the longer we wait, the more building costs will increase. Lastly, I would like to thank the board for allowing us to speak on our behalf. When making your decision, I would like to ask the board to put the NIMBY issues aside and instead focus on the items that are really up for decision. I ask that the volunteer members' safety also be taken into consideration, because the longer this is delayed, the more health and safety issues there will be at our current facility. The purpose of going through the process was to get feedback from each of the boards and not to put the entire project back on the drawing table. The entire ambulance department and board of trustees have spent lots and lots of time planning and doing research to find the best option. Together, we have found this solution to be the best, and I am confident that there has been enough information presented to make an educated decision on this. And lastly, I would just like to submit, last week in the Southampton Press, there's a letter to the editor by Mr. Jonke himself. This letter clearly offers no constructive criticism. It simply just states, anywhere but here. So I'd just like to submit that on record, which you can include in the file. That's all I have. I'd like to ask our assistant chief to come up.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Dan Berry. I'm first assistant chief of the SVVA, chairman, members of the board. During the initial design phase of this project, we met directly with the community members who advocated for and were directly responsible for the installation of the dog park. We did this to find out if they had any concerns with the location of the building as well as its design. As it turns out, they did have a few concerns, but they were easily addressed by making some changes to the design of the building and the layout of the landscaping. Interestingly enough, the potential for the sound of emergency sirens was not a concern. Again, the people directly responsible for the installation of the dog park, who presumably have the best interests of dogs in mind, were not concerned about potential siren noise. just to address something, apparently the legal representation for the opposition is some kind of authority on dogs and dog behavior. I don't know, is he suggesting we should bring in like a dog psychologist? I don't know. Additionally, he seems to have an awful lot of assumptions about the members of this community and how they perceive the park. The bottom line is an overwhelming majority of voters approve this project. As EMS providers, one of our most important responsibilities is to advocate for our patients. This includes all past, present, and future patients. As such, one of our primary goals is to ensure that we are able to get to our patients in the most expedient manner possible. A major component of this, as with many things, is location, location, location. On behalf of our patients, we have advocated for a centralized location within the village in an effort to equalize our response times to every corner of the village from the new ambulance facility. Additionally, since we are volunteers, we do not spend a large amount of time at the headquarters just waiting for calls. Sometimes the opportunity presents itself, but for the most part, we are working, we're attending school, we're spending time with our families, and attending to a multitude of other responsibilities. That being the case, our response times are just as much affected by our members' ability to get to headquarters as quickly and as easily as possible. Obviously, in exploring the various options for possible sites for new ambulance headquarters, these were major concerns of ours. There has been a lot of back and forth over the past 7 years, but luckily the mayor and the village board of trustees have been very open to hearing and considering our concerns. Ultimately, it has been agreed upon by the members of the SVVA, the very people who have the utmost knowledge pertaining to such matters as responding to headquarters and from there responding to patients, that the new site next to the police station will at worst have no impact on our response times. However, more than likely, The location of the new ambulance facility will actually improve our response times. Furthermore, for a member of the community to get up here and insinuate otherwise, based on a tendentious simulacrum of knowledge concerning traffic in this village, is not only a disservice to this community, but quite frankly, an insult to the highly trained men and women of the SBVA, who volunteer their time to serve the community by way of suggesting that we are not acting with the best interests of our patients in mind and rejecting our responsibilities as EMS providers. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would like to ask one of our long-term members to come up, who's been with the agency for about 23 years and would know the most about responding to calls as anyone.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and board members. My name is Don Mahoney, 98 Palm Street, Southampton. I want to take this opportunity to address the board as the longest standing active member of the SBVA. Having been a member for almost 23 years, I've seen the agency go through many changes and growth. We started with a rented ambulance that was parked on North Sea Road where Randy's Barbershop formerly was. Then it moved to behind Village Hall. Mastic Beach donated our first ambulance, and the Grattan family was gracious enough to donate their garage on Hampton Road. When Range Rover came in, Henry Hildreth was gracious enough to allow us to park our ambulance in the basement of one of his warehouses. When the village took back our current facility, we had a home. We purchased another unit from East Hampton, which was an old ambulance that was then retrofitted to be a fire support vehicle, and we retrofitted it back to be an ambulance. The agency has grown from 8 or 10 individuals to our current roster, and during that time, so has the village. The area is much more of a year-round community now and has a direct correlation with our call volume. Rescue apparatus has grown in size as well. The ambulances are now mandated to carry much more equipment to meet state protocols, and there are many more safety features for the personnel treating the patient in the rear quarters of the ambulances. Our agency, like all other on the East End, are now staffed with 24/7 paramedics to provide a higher level of emergency care. Record keeping for legal reasons as well as medications, etc., is drastic and the protocols for storage are very cumbersome. Special areas with multiple levels of access are needed. Certain medications must be kept in climate control areas as well. As the agency has grown, the direct correlation to the indirect correlation to the community, our equipment and government regulations have as well. We have clearly outgrown our current facility. The process of constructing a new facility to meet the current needs of the organization as well as the state and county mandates began in 2009. Here we are 7 years later, after years of looking at different locations, working on plans for two, if not three buildings, after vetting multiple sites. There's finally a bond vote, the village residents approved it, and now we are hearing about the issues? It's absolutely ridiculous. The village board started with past boards. It did its homework and due diligence and came up with the best possible location and design. Now that we are ready to get rolling, we now have to deal with outside issues. There have been multiple public hearings, meetings, and other venues, which Rick spoke about earlier, for the community to come and address over the last 7 years. PowerPoint presentations, community open houses, invitations to come view our current facility, understand our cramped quarters, and the real need for a new facility. I've heard our major opponent has suggested we go to the Windmill Lane Firehouse. Mike spoke of that earlier. That was one of the alternate facilities initially considered by the village board. There were actually conceptual plans drawn for that location. It does not work for our needs, and it is clearly evident that the location was looked into initially. Furthermore, it's an active firehouse, as Mike spoke of, housing 3 or 4 pieces of equipment that respond to every call. So it's far from vacant. It's used regularly for rescue calls as well as meetings for the fire department. Speaking of meetings, we currently have to hold our EMS meetings off-site. We cannot fit all our members into our current building. As for concerns about traversing Windmill Lane, I think it will be a non-issue. I've personally driven the ambulance down Windmill Lane many times over the past 23 years. I've never had an issue. I feel strongly this location will actually be much safer than the current one. Many responding members now have to traverse Jobs Lane or Main Street in the business district to get to the facility. The chances of people walking out between cars, tighter streets, children, it's much more dangerous in the current location, quite frankly. With a new location, we would only be going through the business district one time if bringing patients from the west. cutting down on the potential liability massively, and if coming from the east or north, we would not be. The new location is a much better location for response times and public safety. I've also heard a number thrown around, 9 calls a day. I think that was our maximum volume, and I can't remember how many years ago that was. A prime example would be today, we had no calls. There can be 3 or 4 days where there's no activity, and there may be a day where there is 3 or 4 calls. But to talk about 9 calls as call volume is just totally a massive cognitive distortion. And to talk about, on another hat, as a New York State certified pesticide applicator, I heard references earlier to increased use of herbicides and insecticides on the property. I can't speak for Larry and the Village Parks Department, but you're going to be cutting down on the grass on that site. So treatments are going to be massively decreased if they're treating the property. The ambulance uses no herbicides. We try to help people, not knock them off. And insecticides, I don't know if the village sprays anything in our building currently, but there's no, we don't have insect issues, and there's no state mandate that we spray our building. So I just think that that's a baseless claim. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Hi, my name is Bob Whitman. I live at 217 Windmill Lane. I want to say that the ambulance facility picked up my mother twice. She was 88 years old. I have ultimate respect for what you guys do, and I thank you so much. But to spend $5 million on a facility to break up a beautiful open piece of parkland in a location that's arguably not that much better.
Bob,
than what you
you need to address the board. Oh. And again, this board is not here, nor is this hearing here, to determine whether or not this building should be built at this location. It's to determine whether or not the site meets the code standards. So
okay, well, this other lady addressed
I appreciate that, but you need to address the board. Okay. And again, the board is only here to determine whether or not the site complies with section 116.38, not whether or not the building should be built or there's a better location or any other aspect of this.
Okay, well, there have been several comments on the location, and I would just like
to
stay.
We don't want to have two wrongs make a right, but again, not interrupt other people. The issue is, what is wrong with the site, or what should be improved with the site, not whether or not the building should be built.
Okay, well, we're taking a site which is a beautiful open, probably the last beautiful open park piece in the village, and creating a $5 million facility there. I maintain, the same as some other people, that the firehouse is the correct way to do this. It could be coordinated with some of the fire engines there and the ambulance facility, and that would save a lot of money, and it's a much better location. And I thank you for your time. And
thank you,
Bo, thank you for clarifying.
Thank you.
Is she up there? 1 minute. I recognize this lady first. We'll get to you, sir, in 1 minute. Thank you.
My name is Maureen Durbin, 97 Breeze Lane, and I'm a former member of SVVA. I've driven the ambulance. I've ridden in the ambulance. First of all, I don't know any ambulance driver in Southampton Village that barrels down our roadways. They drive cautiously. As a driver of the ambulance, you do not always have your siren on. So as far as the noise is concerned, there are many times where you called on a call and the siren is not on. There's many things about driving an ambulance that the general public does not know that I felt was important to hear. Ambulance drivers do not barrel. They use lights and sirens when there's an emergency. They do not use lights and sirens all the time. I live on Breeze Lane. I go down White Street, out onto Windmill Lane, 3 or 4 times a day. A lot depends on how courteous the other drivers are. If people understand that an ambulance has lights and sirens on, there to get out of the way. You can get down Windmill Lane if people are courteous. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir. I'll get you next, Molly, just one more sec.
Okay. Hi, my name is Molly Ferrer. I live on White Street. Is it appropriate, Bo, to talk about traffic?
Yes.
I keep it in mind if I'm going, well, I agree with Bob. I've also, my family members, you ambulance, you're great, and you're volunteers, and thank you. You're terrific for our village. We appreciate it. I think about when I'm going to the Walbaums on a Friday, that it's just around the corner from my house. If I am coming back on Windmill Lane, it is literally like the light has to change three times sometimes for me to get heading back toward White Street from the Walbaums. There's no shoulders on either side of Windmill Lane at that point in Windmill Lane. And literally, if a driver wanted to pull over to make room for an ambulance, there isn't a place to pull over. It can literally be gridlock on that one portion of Windmill Lane. I'm not here to say anything about it, the open space, the dog park, whatever, but I worry that somebody in extremis, really you guys would be stalled getting out of Windmill Lane if it happened to be on a weekend or any time in July and August. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, board members. My name is Joe Hurley. I've been with the ambulance for 14 years, and currently I'm a driver. I was asked by the chief I would step up and talk a little bit about the traffic and the driving since I'm the one who does it. I've responded to about 2,700 calls in 14 years. I feel comfortable saying to you that I've probably driven Windmill Lane 200 times on ambulance calls. And I'm here to tell you, I have never had a problem. At the south end, we have 5 lanes, 2 for parking, 3 for traveling. At the north end, we have 3 lanes, no parking. When we go down Windmill Lane, we get in the middle lane at a reasonable rate of speed. There is no reason in Southampton Village to go more than 30 miles an hour. Now, the hospital is in the middle of the district. Middle lane, people pull over. We do not lean on the siren. This is not New York City. We don't have to sit in an intersection blasting everybody out of their apartment. We come to an intersection. If we see a dangerous situation, we give it a toot. We move on. There's plenty of room to move over with 3 lanes. The traffic moves to the side. They sit at the curb. We go straight. Not a problem. If we have to enter or exit Windmill Lane, we can't do that at speed anyway because there are drain gutters on both sides. If we're to rapidly go through those drain gutters, the EMT in the back of the rig who's tending to patients is going to smash his head on the roof, and we have 2 patients. So we have to stop. We have to go slow. Windmill Lane is not an issue as far as we are traversing it. And we have done many, many calls. If you go up and down, you can see a number of places where there would be calls. Finally, not only is Windmill Lane a good place, it is the best place. Whenever we have a call, there are 3 things that mitigate response time. One is traffic, one is the weather, and one is the distance from where we are to the patient. We can control them from headquarters to the patient because we have traffic control devices, we have sirens and lights if we need them. If we have bad weather, we're in contact with dispatch. They tell us where trees are down. They tell us what's flooding. If it's a serious weather condition, we take our vehicles and we disperse them around the village. We put them in the firehouses. We keep one in our place. We have a crew sleeping there on the floor because we have no place else to put them. But we do disperse them. So we can deal with these situations from headquarters to the patient and mitigate our response time. But most importantly, our current building is centrally located. So we don't have to go any great distance to get to any one patient. Second, when people have talked about response time, they've talked about it as one big thing. It is not, it's 3. There are 3 responses because once you get to the patient, you have to get them to the hospital. And the situation there is the same that it is when you go from the ambulance building to the patient. There are 3 things to consider: weather, traffic, location. And again, it's all mitigated because the hospital is in the center of the village. We have the assistance of the police. We have a very serious call. I've been on 3 of them in the past couple of years, where PD gave us an escort to get a dying patient to the hospital. So these are mitigated. But the one response that no one seems to talk about, except Don and Dan mentioned it tonight, is the volunteer getting from wherever they are to the ambulance. That's where your time limit is. Now, I live in Shinnecock Hills. The socioeconomic demographic of this community has changed dramatically in 30 years. When that current building was built, everybody lived in the village. They could walk to the building. That's no longer the case. I was told a year ago that approximately two-thirds of the properties in this village are owned by part-timers and no-timers. I asked a village official, is that accurate? And they said, it's not far off. And then you consider what's left, a significant percentage of them are elderly who have been in that house 40, 50 years, and they plan to die there. That's not a great pool of volunteers. So we have gone outside. Our volunteers now come from Shinnecock Hills. I'm from Shinnecock Hills. There are three of my neighbors are also volunteers in the village ambulance. They come from Tuckahoe. They come from North Sea. They don't come from Watermill because that's a higher socioeconomic demographic. They don't come from down on Gin Lane and Meadow Lane. So putting an ambulance building over there is ridiculous because now you have these volunteers coming from north, coming from west, coming from the northwest, who now have to continue to navigate Job's Lane, Main Street, Hampton Road, Nugent Street, which is gridlock, absolute gridlock. Windmill Lane is never gridlock. So, I beg to differ, sir, because I have done over 150 calls on Windmill Lane, and if you'd like to ride with me sometime, you've got my invitation.
I live on Windmill.
I lived on Halsey Street.
It is gridlock.
The point being, I have never had a problem. But getting back to it, our volunteers coming from those three areas could easily get to Windmill Lane. They cannot get to Meeting House Lane where we are now. They can not get to any residential neighborhood in the village. If it isn't the traffic, it's the landscaping vehicles and the construction vehicles blocking the roads, which is our big problem on Meeting House Lane now. So as they speak about the traffic problems, as a driver in the ambulance, I beg to differ. Because I think Windmill Lane is not the wrong place. I think it's the only viable place.
Good evening, Chairman, Board, Bill. My name is Richard Yastrzemski, and I'm the Southampton Village Trustee. I think a lot of points, very salient points, have been brought up this evening. Joe, right there, you covered a lot about the traffic. Thank you very much. I really implore the public out viewing and sitting here tonight, along with the board, as I'm supposed to address, so. You can see the passion. You can hear the passion. You can sense it in these volunteers. That's because they've been in a very poor facility for very long, and they've been going through this process a very long time. So on their behalf, I know it, and I've been a board member on the village board for 8 years. So part of one of the first things I've been addressing since I became elected was what to do with this SVVA and where it should go. And I know, Bo, thank you for pointing out, we're really talking about this particular property and why here. So forgive me if I just kind of pointed a few things that some people did.
I guess you're entitled, Richard.
Well, as a board member, I need people to realize that this is not a decision that has come by any means lightly. Now, Joe and others touched on the traffic. Quite honestly, there was really no great place in this village in the height of the summer season where these emergency vehicles are able to navigate without issue. You have to keep in mind that their current facility is on Meeting House Lane, a street that I believe is more narrow than Windmill Lane and is a direct path to the hospital and downtown, church, and so forth. So they are currently, and have been for many years, just in this location alone, they're already accustomed to having a tough time getting in and out of their ambulance barn. They do it very well so far without issue. So they're already accustomed to that. A concern was brought up about this particular location and its proximity to a residential area and the noise and the sirens. Again, I submit its current location is in the heart of a residential area, and how they mitigate the noise. I think somebody brought up sirens in one of the public comment was they typically do not use the sirens exiting the building, and of course, unless there is a vehicle in front of them on the street. So they are already aware of how to be good neighbors, if you will, to a residential neighborhood. So, but from my perspective, of course, why here, why now? And it was brought up, a piece of property was mentioned by a gentleman earlier. Obviously, as a board member, we've examined all of that. reviews traffic studies, reviews reports. We utilize all our boards. As a board of trustee up here, all our respective boards, but we have you guys. We rely on your input and your study and of all the specialists and the lawyers, I know, more than I do. So putting it where it is now, as opposed to, let's say, the one location that was offered, things get considered there. The cost of it. Our underlying goal, one, is to provide a proper facility for our volunteers and our EMS personnel, while also being extremely, extremely aware of our taxpayers' dollars, because I am myself a taxpayer. I live here. So while the numbers thrown out, numbers we've looked at for many years, what we've also come to the conclusion is that it has to be done. It has to go somewhere. It's never going to get cheaper. So we'll take that out of the equation. Where does it go? Many locations were looked at, studied, analyzed, a few mentioned this evening, as a matter of fact, some that aren't village property. So one property that was mentioned is a private piece of property. Well, that would add to the cost of the construction of the facility, because we'd have to buy the property first. So those things were already taken into account by this board and others, but certainly my board, I'll speak for, and myself. Why this facility needs to go here, its location has been addressed by these men and women here this evening, so I'm not going to belabor that, because they did a very good job in covering that. From my point of view, it's been studied that that's a good location, based on all alternatives, and even they've even addressed that it's great despite that. Secondly, more importantly, on behalf of a taxpayer, we own the property. We don't have to buy it. That saves a hell of a lot of money in the construction cost, which was brought up about the cost to the taxpayer. We're extremely cognizant of that. That's why this is a location that we ended up choosing and going with for the SVVA headquarters. So again, I just wanted to come up. I heard a few comments tonight, all good, some which have been touched on in the past by my own board meetings and the public at open houses. There have been some new questions brought up, which is great. You have a job, obviously, to address and listen to everybody up here. But just as my little part of my role I play in this, I just wanted to how I came to the decision, why this property is the place for it to be, for their needs, while also keeping in account the needs of the taxpayer in the village of Southampton. And that's what we're here to do. So thank you for your time.
Thank you. Does anybody else have anything to add?
I'm Rick Stott. I'm the architect for the project. I've been involved in it the whole 7 years. And I want to thank Rich for his comments and interest in this project, because he was with us from the beginning. He was one of the first people that we met with and began to talk about different locations. He's right. We did include some private property. The one that was mentioned tonight at the time was an active dealership, a car dealership. It was not an abandoned lot, so it was basically out of the question for us then. There were other comments tonight, a few other comments that I'd like to address. First of all, this is not parkland. It is not park property. It's not greenfield property. It's property owned by the village. We're planning this project to be a LEED certified building. For those who don't know, LEED means Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. The LEED process is part of the United States Green Building Council, and it addresses all of the environmental issues that can go along with building a project. From the selection of the site, in fact, it's advantageous that this site is close to public transportation, in the form of both bus routes and train station. So it qualifies for points in that area. It's not built on a green field, which means a parkland or something that's designated not to be developed. In fact, there's been planning done for the village by professionals in the past in 2013 that says this is exactly the location it should be developed for civic buildings that are adjacent to the police station. So other community activities, other civic activities were considered to be best located there by the Eshcut study that was done in 2013. As a planner and architect, the neighbors ought to have known that a long time ago instead of waiting till the final hour to make a complaint. There was a comment about the gym, which I think Rick addressed very well. There's a gym also at the police station that's about twice the size of the one planned here. Our volunteers, we all know how great they are, and Rick made some very good points about them being away from the site when a call comes in. Even the LEED process itself considers where people come from that use the building. So if they have to travel by law to go work out in a place, they're certainly increasing their carbon footprint if they have to get in their car to go there and get in their car to come back. By doing that, we're helping both the traffic issues in the village and helping our volunteers stay fit. There was a comment made tonight that no one in this room, and this is a quote, no one in this room is able to adequately assess traffic issues. I think you've heard to the contrary on both counts, that Windmill Lane is not a big issue, that when it is an issue, the drivers of these ambulances use proper protocol. They don't turn their lights and sirens on at will just for the sake of it, that they use them only when they're needed. So the fact that an ambulance may originate from the middle of Windmill Lane instead of the southern part of Windmill Lane where it was suggested that the building be better located, or whether they originate from Meeting House Lane where they are now, if their route of travel requires that they use Windmill Lane, they're going to use the same discretion whether the ambulance originates from that location, the proposed location or not. I don't see it making any difference in terms of a disturbance in that area. I see it making an enormous difference in terms of the disturbance of Main Street and Job's Lane. My office is right next door at 13. Last summer, I witnessed an ambulance trying to go north on Main Street. There was a woman waiting to pull into a parking space. She wouldn't move. Turned on the lights, wouldn't move. Hit the sirens, still wouldn't move. She's waiting for a parking spot, but would not give up waiting for someone to back out to get out of the way of the ambulance. It took minutes of time before finally a police car showed up behind the ambulance and pulled around the ambulance and told the woman to move. And I watched the whole thing. I don't know how anyone could think that it's a worse place in the middle of Windmill Lane where those things don't happen and people aren't waiting to park their cars. So again, this is not park property. It's village property and it's next to a park. It's a LEED building that was very carefully planned. In fact, this is a big day for us because we finished plans and have them ready to go to bid tomorrow with your positive vote tonight. This package represents 96 pages of drawings. There were more than a dozen professionals involved in this project, including a LEED professional who's looking over the LEED process, consulting engineers for mechanical, electrical, and plumbing. We have the village's other contracted site designers, Aris Design. And on top of 96 pages of drawings, there's 1,000 pages of specifications. We've planned this very, very carefully for many, many years. We're really looking forward to getting this building online and getting it into a better location where the volunteers can help provide services for the village for the next 100 or so years. We definitely think this is the best place. Because a couple of neighbors haven't been paying attention until the very last minute and then come out against this, I hope it's not a reason to postpone this decision.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to respond with respect to these comments. I am mindful of the jurisdiction of the planning board, as the planning board under section 116-138. You're sitting here, by the way, as the lead agency. one of the factors, it's not dispositive, but one of the factors is the, is whether or not the applicant has demonstrated a mitigation with respect to environmental impact. Alternative uses is an appropriate consideration with respect to mitigation. What about the fact that, notice, this has been going on for since 2009? Well, it has been going on in 2009, but number one, it was a, frankly, it was a generic approach as to what the village was intending to do, not specific. The actual traffic report was done only in March of 2016, and that itself is not the basis of any traffic study at all, except to note what the historical use of traffic ambulances leaving the old facility was. No traffic study was done with respect to June, July, August, or September. A traffic study done several years ago, by the way, is frankly really not probative of the increased intensive use with respect to it, with respect to Windmill Lane. And let me remind the board that the police department was originally cited for this parcel. Without changing the configuration of the lot or doing anything else, a village court was added, which added even additional burdens to the area, which in itself was at that point certainly reached its maximum stressful capacity. Now what the applicant is seeking to do is to add yet another layer of use, in addition to the dog use, in addition to other parking facilities unrelated to the ambulance, which will now have more of an impact in that area. And with respect to whether or not it is a park, it is used as a park. One does not have to know the rules and laws with respect to park laws or in the country or in the state to conclude that this acreage is a vacant parcel of land consisting of lawn, used as a park, and that's how moms and pops regard it as such. It is, there is no other inconsistent use other than a park at that particular site. With respect to barreling down the road, it's not my intention to say that ambulances barrel down the road, but we all know, and all, with all due respect, with the wonderful job that the members here do for the village, we all know that when there is an emergency, they go faster than otherwise because they have to get to the hospital. On Windmill Lane, when they are originating from the spot, not the current facility, but they're now originating from where the police department is to get onto Windmill Lane, there is immediate command decisions that have to be made to get onto that road quickly, which is already congested during June, July, August, and September. My point is, there's no traffic study that adequately addresses that with respect to that issue. I think that's, I said enough. Our position is that there has not been a hard look with respect to the discrete environmental issues. They are summarized in the report by Dr. Padone. By the way, one consideration, and I know Mr. Robinson and I have been talking about this, is for example, what are adequate mitigation measures? Given an EAF report that was done in January 2016, not 9 years ago, by the way, but just recently, given a traffic report that was done in March of 2016, not 9 years ago, but done just recently, I think that it is fair and appropriate that the residents of the community, now that we all understand that you're targeting a specific, the village, I should say, not you, is targeting a specific area, that we be given the opportunity, first of all, not only that you board consider the whether or not you've taken a hard look, and I call attention to the report that was just given tonight, but also specific measures, for example, that are noise abatement and traffic abatement, that will go a long way in enabling and assuring the residents that the land is going to be maximized for its use as a park, in a manner that minimizes noise, and in a manner that does not adversely increase the amount of traffic given the already congested area of traffic that currently exists. Thank you.
Does anybody else weigh in on this issue?
Hi. Jane Clare, 123 Cooper's Farm Road.
Please use the mic.
Hi. Jane Clare. 123 Cooper's Farm Road, and this literally is my backyard, and I have no complaints. I have just one concern. Will any vehicles drive on the green belt there? That's my question.
The green belt off your road?
Between White Street and yeah.
Yeah, I'm just worried about, because I won't be able to get out, because there is gridlock there. I walk or ride a bike. I'm worried they're gonna go out the green belt with their vehicles. And that's my question is that been considered?
Not in the plan.
I can answer that. Well,
why don't you say that?
You can have a little break.
But these guys aren't answering, they're not saying no, we don't do it.
Hi, I'm Joe Backwar from 205B and 215 Windmill Lane. The police do use the green belt right now, the reserve behind there, to access White Street whenever they feel like it during the summer months. And it's consistent throughout the whole summer. So for anyone to sit here and say, an ambulance isn't going to follow what the police do, it's kind of hard to believe that that wouldn't happen in that situation. I mean, I have my kids at our house, and we can't go back there sometimes because we don't know when that fire trucks are, not the fire truck, sorry, the police station is going to use that road to access White Street. It's scary not knowing how they're going to come back through what was a park, which is now an impound lot, and go back and use either side of Breeze Lane or White Street. It's sad that they don't even acknowledge that this is an issue with traffic on Windmill Lane. It's just incredible to me that no one will accept that there's traffic backups all the time, and even our own police station uses the reserve to access White Street or Breeze Lane, or Cooper's Farm Lane, sorry. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
I would just like to address that concern. The ambulances are considerably heavier than police cruisers. We would never run the risk of getting our ambulance stuck in a response. So there would be no reason to use, I'm not even sure what he's talking about, but it sounds like there's grass, and I know the soil in the village, it gets very muddy and heavy. I don't see any reason as to why we would ever use that. And again, you know, I felt like enough has been said, but getting out onto Windmill Lane will not be an issue. Additionally, as far as green space goes, just down the street, you have Agawam Park. Actually, there's a picture of part of it right behind you. It's beautiful. Why would anybody want to sit up there when they have this space is beyond me. I mean, as far as, you know, my wife brings the kids into the village. They don't go up there. They go to Agawam because there's a playground, there's a pond, there's things to do and see, there's a fountain. You know, it's right next to stores you can walk to. Mugged in this village? No. It's in the city. You know, I don't, so that, to me, that's hardly a concern. I don't know. I guess that's...
If I could add one thing about getting out onto Windmill Lane. As Mr. Hill has stated, we will be using an Opticom device, which would clear out the area prior to the ambulance entering Windmill Lane. There's an automated signal on the ambulance when the emergency lights are activated. So as it's pulling out of the ambulance headquarters, it will trigger the traffic lights in the area to clear out that section. So getting out to Windmill Lane should not be an issue. And there's highly trained personnel already on that.
Thank you. One more thing, I'm sorry. In regards to the traffic in the village, we've all driven all over the village, every roadway, everywhere. In the summertime, traffic's a problem. There's nothing we can do about it. There's traffic everywhere. I would like anybody to point out one street in this village that you could say, well, there's no traffic there, so let's put the ambulance building up. Thank you.
I'd like to thank everybody for their opinions that they've been expressed tonight. It's obviously a issue of concern, and many great points have been made. We've been discussing this application as a board for several months now, and if my fellow board members concur, I would like to move to formally close the public comment on this application.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. That said, I want everyone to be sure that this board has taken a hard look at the concerns that the neighbors brought up regarding the EAF. So, Kathy, if you concur that it's, we need a little more time to respond or go over this in even further detail than we already have, I would be willing to postpone voting again on this issue to the next meeting. But Mr. Robinson, what is your opinion as far as making sure that we've crossed every T and dotted every I in terms of our hard look at the environmental impact?
From what I've heard tonight, I think that, and the commentary of Mr. Bovina, I think that Nelson Pope and Voorhees should have the opportunity to review the report that was submitted and address specifically those issues. However, what I'm also sensing here is sort of an up or down vote or an up or down situation on this. I appreciate that the objectants may have been pressed for time to respond to this, but I think it's fair to say that in this interim period, Mr. Bovina, if your clients have any suggestions as to specifically what to do about any issues they perceive, that the board should allow those to be submitted, because if this just comes to an up or down vote on whether or not there's a negative declaration or not, then it precludes any further considerations of these issues. And I didn't see anything here tonight that somebody said, well, suggest what might be added to this equation or what might be added to the site plan or detracted from it that would please your clients. So all I can say is that time is of the essence, I think, at this stage of this proceeding. These people need to go forward. As Rick said, the plans have now been submitted. It's been before this board now, I think, for 3 months at least in a public hearing phase. And in all fairness to everybody, this needs to move forward and not just go into a monthly rotation of proposal, counterproposal, proposal, counterproposal. So those are my thoughts, Roy, to only modify the closure by saying let the applicants submit whatever positive considerations or suggestions they've got, close it for other comment, and then await for the report of Nelson, Pope, and Voorhees based upon their analysis of the report submitted this evening.
Yes, sir.
You know, in response to what Mr. Robinson said.
Could you please step to the mic?
Absolutely.
Thanks.
Sure. In response to what Mr. Robinson said, and Mr. Chairman, your point as well, if we had a meaningful, if there was a dialogue that takes place, that is, the record is kept open, at least for the purpose of responding, first of all, to the report that was given tonight, and also included in that window is an opportunity to discuss meaningful mitigation measures that takes into account noise and traffic and its conversion of a vacant park into something other than a park. And my clients certainly will be committed to respond promptly to the recommendations and colloquy offered by the board so that this proceeds in a manner that is in the best interest of everyone concerned. So, and again, our issue is, understand, there's no hard look. We're not able to conclude, the board is not able to conclude, one way or the other, frankly, given this record, as to what is the best practicable environmental study and impact associated with this project. And that is what's essential for purposes of you deciding whether or not a neg deck should be issued. So I recommend that the consideration of a neg deck resolution be adjourned. During this window of time, as Mr. Chairman, you had suggested, and also even Mr. Robinson, that we have this discussion, prompt one, by the way, that takes into account the engineer's report and any and other ideas with respect to noise and traffic abatement and other issues that are relevant to the EAF and to the report given by Dr. Padone. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Robinson.
So, gentlemen from the ambulance service, I know you'd like to see this project move forward, but I believe that it's incumbent upon this board to make sure that whatever decision this board makes can stand up to any potential scrutiny moving down the road, and therefore I think we really, I know you've waited a long time, and there has been a lot of discussion in a lot of different areas regarding this application. I need to ask for your patience for another brief period of time for this board to listen to any potential recommendations, listen to our consultants' response to questions which have been raised, so that we can make a definitive judgment without any questions being unanswered. So if I might have a motion to adjourn this application at this point, based on the recommendations that our council has made.
Closing for public comments, subject only to consideration of the issues raised by the opponents.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
So the motion passes. Thank you all for your participation.
Thank you.
And then take a look at the implied.
They want an up or down.
So it's gonna be one way or the other. It's not gonna be something in the middle. Sometimes you gotta play hard.
So now we're going to go to All right, thank you, everybody. Moving on, the next public item in public hearing is the application of 550 and 554 Hill Street.
I want to take a break.
Come back tomorrow.
Good evening. I'm Anthony Tohill, 12 First Street, Riverhead. I'm covering for Gil Flanagan tonight. You're all very familiar with this application, so I'm going to be mercifully brief. This is property at 550 and 554 Hill Street, occupied right now by two residences and a very large industrial building, the former site of Dispatch Moving and Storage. So there are three uses on the site, and if this application were approved, there would be three uses in the aftermath. However, the industrial use would be eliminated, and instead you would have three residential uses. The access to two of the lots is on Hill Street by a single driveway, replacing the two driveways that are there now. The other access to the back lot would be a single driveway on Captain's Neck, and that would be it. David Amelita is here. He's handled the planning and environmental issues to date. I'm sure if you have any questions, he's going to be able to answer them. Other than that, I know that I've been sitting with the opposition, who I was happy, by the way, to see, because I thought I had arrived late, and it was good for me to see that the opposition was still sitting there waiting, too. So we stayed together prior to this. And so I'm going to sit down and let the opponents address the issues, all right? Thank you. And I'll answer any questions if you have.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is David Egan, and I'm from the law firm of Egan and Matthews. We maintain our offices at 241 Pantego Road in East Hampton. I appear tonight on behalf of PHB Realty Corp, the owner of 48 Captain's Neck and adjoining property. This doesn't have the 9-year history of the bus of barn, but this application has been around in the village for quite a long time. Also, I remember appearing about 3.5 years ago in front of the ZBA on this matter. We're here to urge one of two actions on your behalf. One, we urge that you deny this application. We believe that it is obvious that it does not comply with the considerations set forth in the code in section 97.2, which control your deliberations of this application. I think if you turn to those sections, section 97-2B1 clearly requires that, and we'll take the easier one first, that this application be consistent with or in conformance with the zoning ordinance and the official map. Well, we know that's not the case. Any application that asks for more lots than what are allowed by the maximum yield clearly is not in compliance. And I know this is not your purview, but any application that requires, by our latest count, at least 33 variances clearly is not in compliance. So that's obviously a serious hurdle for the applicant to overcome, and I don't see that happening.
Do you have a list of what those variances are?
Actually, I do. My office prepared one today. I only have one copy, but I'd be glad to submit it to the board if you'd like.
Can you submit that copy, or do you need to make copies of that?
No, I can give you this copy. Do we have no more? Okay. Sorry, my office is also here now. Okay, thank you. Thank you. More importantly,
could you raise the mic and speak into the mic a bit?
I'm sorry.
Great, thanks.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. More importantly, that same section 97-2B1, which is really, I think, the one that's going to guide your deliberations, makes it clear that this application, any subdivision application, needs to be in conformance with the master plan of this village. This application clearly is not. We've been through the plan in detail, and it's clear that the plan does not contemplate a downzoning of this property, which is really what is being asked here. This application started out asking for four lots with seven dwellings on it. It's been reduced after a number of years now to three lots with five dwellings on it. That is clearly, is such an increase in density that what you're talking about here, based on the number of variances which the ZBA would have, to grant, the significance of those variances, both individually and cumulatively, this is a rezoning of this property is being asked. And just as I believe we successfully argued 3.5 years ago, that the zoning board, the relief, which we think is still in the same category as being way too much to be asking for through a normal process of a ZBA and a planning board, this really should be considered only by the village trustees in the form of a request to rezone this property. And I believe that anything short of that, you're really stretching the intended jurisdiction of these boards. Now, with respect to the master plan, it's clear that there is no anticipation or discussion in there of any change in zone for this neighborhood. If you look at the plan itself, it makes a number of statements about zoning. The first one on page 76, it says, for the most part, Southampton's zoning districts are serving the village well. Zones are located in the right place, and there's no need to create wholly new zones or eliminate zones. And I think when this zone was put in, when there is a split zone on this property, as you know, and when two-thirds of it was put in by the village trustees in R120, that was a purposeful act by them to ensure that the density of these lots would remain what they are. Two lots, two houses, that's what people get. What this application is asking for is special treatment, which we don't think exists in the law, and therefore I think it's precluded. Going on in the comprehensive plan, under zoning, there's even a discussion of non-conforming uses. And it calls out some examples of where the village board felt there was a need to eliminate and change non-conforming uses. One of them is obviously the Rambo property. And if you look on page 25 of the master plan, there's a discussion of the West and Southern Village Center, which I believe would include this particular lots. And there's a number of specific examples given where the trustees felt some changes in zoning were appropriate to achieve that goal. This property is not mentioned. So I think it's unequivocal that the master plan, which by this section of the code is guides your decision and limits it, that there's nothing in this plan that supports this application. And for that purpose, and for that reason, principally, we ask that you deny it. There's a number of other considerations listed in that section. None of them really are called out and are relevant. I think we've emphasized B1 as really being the section that I think controls and ultimately leads you to the conclusion that this application should be denied. I just want to make one other point on the issue of, there's been a lot of discussion about the justification and the reason for this, and it's always described as the elimination of this industrial building. I don't think it's an industrial building, I think it's a commercial building. I think that's true. And what my clients say who live there is that the use of this building and the intensity of it has waned considerably over the years. And this is not really used as a storage facility for a large moving company, and they're very much. And what's really morphed into is a storage facility for some of the local contractors. And that, as a whole, the intensity is not significant. To the people who live on Captain's Neck, they don't see a lot of it because of the building itself. And if they have their druthers, and since they're the most impacted, at least my neighbor, I can speak for my client, they're perfectly satisfied with the status quo. They're not offended by this facility whatsoever. So, and also importantly, I don't believe that the elimination of that commercial use really plays into these considerations. They don't really fit into this because there's nothing in the master plan that talks about the elimination of this commercial use when they went and picked particular ones. So I don't think it's really relevant in that respect. And I know common law, there's a belief that non-conforming commercial uses should be extinguished, but that's not done at a cost of increasing density and other stuff. It's a natural thing that these things should move, not expand. They should be maybe replaced with another one. But all those issues and all that stuff is really irrelevant to this board. I believe that the issue about the elimination of the commercial use would only become relevant to the ZBA if they're asked to look at these variances. And when they do their balancing test, that's when it becomes relevant. I don't think it's relevant to you. I think you're pretty much controlled by the master plan and the code. And I think the master plan and the code tells you that what they're asking for is too much, and there's no reason for them to get it or for you to grant it that would fit into any of these standards or considerations. So I think that's why your discretion on this is rather limited. So we would urge you to deny the application at this time. Now, I'd just like to talk a little bit about the access. The second access that's been discussed and wanting to, there's now two accesses today on Hill Street. I think everyone views this property as being related to Hill Street. It's a Hill Street address, it's a Hill Street neighborhood. to introduce a separate access from an, from Captain's Neck, I think really brings up questions about not following good planning. It doesn't make sense to implicate a whole new neighborhood and an unrelated lot, even though it's owned by the same person, into this subdivision, in effect. I don't think that's good planning. I think it's hard to justify. And I don't think it's considered good planning to give people extra accesses to different parts of the neighborhood, principally because they believe they're going to get an increase in their economic return. I don't think that's a proper consideration of this board. And to the extent that it is part of your consideration, I don't think it's enough to overcome the deficiencies that are otherwise presented by the application. And we also note that I believe that although it may not violate the exact wording of, let me get the right code section, your code section regarding lot and block requirements set forth in 9738. But there's certainly a discussion in there limiting the ability to create flag lots. And although this technically wouldn't be a flag because the easement area that was being offered up is not part of the lots, but I think if you look at this, the spirit of what these provisions are, this flag lots don't, this does not meet the requirements of a flag lot. And so we think that it's violative of that section of the code also. And finally, with CEQA, I'm not sure where you are on CEQA. I don't think you've made a determination yet, but we would ask that if and when you do, if you don't otherwise deny this application, which I believe the time has come to do that, we would ask that you would consider a positive declaration. I think part two of the prior EAF had identified four areas of potentially large impacts. I believe that they have not been mitigated sufficiently by the reduction from four lots to three, or from the reduction of proposed seven dwellings on those properties down to five. I think that those impacts are still considered large by any stretch of the imagination, and certainly large when compared to existing zoning, which is two lots and two houses. So with that, we would urge you to deny this application. And short of that, we would ask for a positive declaration before and then at DIS, and to begin to address the obvious impacts of this proposal on this existing neighborhood. Thank you. If there's any questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
David, one question. You mentioned earlier in your presentation that this matter should be before the village trustees.
Yes.
It's been in front of, it was in front of the Board of Appeals a number of years ago. It's been in front of this board, as you point out, about three years.
Yes.
Why hasn't a challenge been legally made to this?
You haven't made any final determinations yet that are challengeable.
So you'd say that this determination has to be made before that would be challenged?
Anyone needs a final determination to challenge.
So what would be the point of saying that it shouldn't be in front of the planning board?
Well, if it's here, then we're saying deny it. The time has come. It's within your powers to do it. They've placed it here. They've charted this path. The applicants charted their own path. So it's here. My colleague has been arriving and been at these meetings for 3.5 years now. So we're here. So
thank you.
We're here, and I think the code says it's time to deny it. Thank you.
Yes, sir, Mr. Bregman.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and board members. My name is Jeff Bragman, 15 Railroad Avenue, East Hampton, New York. I represent two clients, Eric Ruttenberg who has property that includes 76 Captain's Lane, and Nick Aquavella, who lives at 22 Captain's Neck. And I have to agree with counsel on one point, and that is that this is a somewhat unusual kind of opposition we're making, because we submitted a number of letters from other neighbors who object to the increasing density and effectively the downzoning of this property, but all of whom also echoed what council said, that is that the existing use there, the commercial use, sounds much more intense to say it's an industrial use, but all of them said that the commercial use is a quiet use, innocuous, not disruptive, used sporadically. And that, in contrast, upping the density on this property would be much more invasive and damaging to the neighborhood. And I know, Dave and Melina, we don't have an EAF Part 2 done on this project. We have an older EAF on a four-lot project. This has been scheduled for a public hearing. And so I was looking over Dave and Melina's remarks in response to a three-lot plan, in which he said, oh, a three-lot plan is consistent with the size of lots in the neighborhood. And that may be true if you put on blinders and you only look to the west, where there's a little row of pre-existing non-conforming lots that obviously predated the zoning on Hill Street. But if you broaden your view and take off your blinders, especially looking to the east, you can see that the lots range in size to much larger lots that Mr. Emelina did not include in his analysis, that these lots, this plan for three lots, was consistent with the neighborhood. And I think, to the contrary, any common sense view of the neighborhood shows that these three lots are not consistent. The property itself is located, 61% of it is located in R120 zoning, but reviewing Mr. Emelita's remarks and reports, you'd never know there was any R120 zoning at all, because effectively they've just erased it from any consideration. The three lots proposed, and there's one other anomaly that I have to point out here that I think is actually a little strange, and that is that lot number one, the one right by Hill Street, is a 20,000 square foot lot. That's nowhere in the neighborhood do they have 20,000 square foot lots except pre-existing non-conforming lots. So not only are they coming up with three lots that completely, the rationale seems to be twofold. First, we're getting rid of an industrial use, which is not an industrial use. And secondly, at one point, the attorney for the applicant said, well, we can fit three conforming A-sized lots, one-acre lots, on the property. And again, it's that kind of nearsightedness, because it's not, this property's not located entirely in an A zone. It's six, most of it actually is an R120 zone. And in the midst of all that, where do they come up with asking for a 20,000 square foot lot, which is nowhere in the neighborhood? But that's what they do. And I have to agree with counsel on this, his reference to the part of your code dealing with flag lots. And I think what I would say, I'd say it slightly differently than what counsel said. And you have a provision that says, yes, you can approve flag lots in minor subdivisions, but there are a couple of provisos, one of which is they're supposed to be, that provided that they're arranged such that there's no difficulty for traffic safety and adequate access. I think council's point is that if you're taking access over somebody else's land to get there, that's not exactly the normal way we do planning in the village of Southampton. And the second thing is, the second condition on using flag lots is that they have to result in larger than usual lots. So I would say, to speak plainly, that I think that this design is something of an evasion of that requirement, because these top two lots coming in off Hill Street are functioning like flag lots, except they've changed the label so that, you know, it's going over a right-of-way rather than a piece of land attached to the lower lot. But the effect is to function as a flag lot. And again, you know, is that good planning? It's really circumventing a requirement that would otherwise exist. Also, I'm concerned that all of the lots, I think it may now, I'm a little confused because initially all of the lots had accessory structures. And I think now, I'm not sure whether all of them do or two of them do, but again, something caught my eye in Dave Emelina's description because he said, oh, these are going to be vehicle storage, pool, support, cabanas, perhaps guest cottages. And that kind of rang a little bell in my brain because it wasn't so long ago that you, not this board, but the zoning board had a case over on Moses Lane. I don't know if you heard about that case, where there was allegedly a pre-existing non-conforming commercial structure. It was a disused garage. And the owner came in and said, oh yeah, I've been using that garage, you know, to do bottling. The neighbors all said it hadn't been used in years. But at any rate, the board looked at it and said, well, you know what? We're going to change that use into a guest cottage. I don't exactly know how you do that under the law. I read the decision. I'm still confused how they did it under the law. So when I see the description here that says, oh, these things might be guest cottages, I think that's something to be concerned about. I also think the applicant owes an explanation to this board, a written explanation that can be evaluated in an EAF Part 2 about what he means by that, what's going on there. So I don't think either of the rationalizations that they're using to justify this plan, that they're getting rid of an industrial building, or that they're bringing lots density into conformity with the neighborhood is in fact a reality. And it really does ignore the fact that 60% of this lot is in the larger zone, the R120 zone. And that's why, you know, when we began, I guess I did appear in front of you, what, a year and a half ago, or pretty long time ago. One thing we did to try to figure out what would be appropriate was what they really want to do is they want to switch the direction of the lines that break up the lots. They want to make, instead of being perpendicular to the street, they want to be parallel to the street. So we came up with a plan that we showed you. I only have one copy of this, but we handed it in, and it is part of your record, but I'm just going to show it to you. I can hand it in again. What we did is we took the same percentage and drew the lots with the lot lines arranged the way they want them to be arranged, parallel to the street, and we used the same proportions. We said, look, 61% of this lot is in this R120 zone, and 39% is in the A district. So let's see what that produces in terms of lots. And you know, oddly enough, it produces, I think, something far more persuasive for the board to look at, because it produces a conforming, it's actually more than conforming, 1 acre lot facing Hill Street. And then the back lot is non-conforming. It has 75,000 square feet instead of 120,000 square feet. But the interesting thing about it is it doesn't require 30 variances, doesn't require 27 variances, it doesn't require 20 variances, or even 5 variances, it requires 1 variance. And I think logic and the orderly administration of zoning practice suggests that when you look at applications, your goal should be to try to generate the maximum degree of compliance with existing zoning that you can. I think you stay sort of, to use a sailing analogy, you stay in nice deep water when you do that. When you start looking at applications, and I think this is the point that council was making, when you start looking at applications that are seeking really excessive numbers of variances, it in effect is a rezoning. So I think what council was really saying is rezonings do belong with the legislature, the village board, not planning boards. And it's a red flag when you see all these variances that are needed. Another thing that no one's talked about, and I'm so delighted to be able to talk today, I've sat in front of this board for I don't know how many meetings where I couldn't say anything. And one thing I wanted to ask a long time ago, because it's another one of these head scratchers in this case, is did you notice that the zoning map here has R20 setbacks on all the lots? I don't know if it didn't seem that anybody made a point of that, but I'm looking at this, I've been looking at this map a long time when I couldn't talk. And I said, what's this map doing with R20 setbacks when the zoning here is A and R120? Like, what's that about? Do I just get to come in and When I do a subdivision, I can pick whatever zoning district I like best, and that's essentially what this applicant has done. He's just picked out R20, and I would suggest that the reason that they did that is because R20 setbacks tend to be generous because they're really designed for much smaller lots. So they're going to produce much more open-looking building envelopes. I don't know where the legal authority comes for that. I'm a little surprised. I'm going to say that, you know, I understand that the applicant is a member of the zoning board, and, you know, they probably talk to every applicant that goes in front of the zoning board and says, hey, you know, you got to comply with the setbacks, and if you can't, you have to comply with them to the maximum extent possible, because we're only going to grant the minimal relief necessary. So again, I think the applicant owes an explanation to your planner so that your planner can produce a proper EAF that evaluates that. I mean, right now you're looking at a map that does not have real building envelopes on it. That's why the attorney got up and said, oh, we've seen that it requires 33 variances, because they're using the wrong, they're not using the correct dimensional requirements. I don't want to go through it. I can tell you that on lot one also, by the way, lacks the required lot width for even an R20 lot, the smallest lot in this proposed subdivision. Lot two has the wrong principal building setbacks. It's got the wrong front yard setbacks. It's got the wrong side yard setbacks, the wrong totals. Same thing with lot three. And I know I want to address something that I've heard in front of this board. You know, it's tempting for you guys to say, well, those are issues for the zoning board. We can't deal with those issues for the zoning board. We can't look at those. Not exactly correct, because we're reviewing this case using CECRA, and CECRA tells the board that an action consists of activities that can constitute many different steps, and that you have to take into account all of the steps. And some of those steps may include approvals by agencies other than you. And so what CECRA is saying is that even though he has to go to the, assuming he can get through the planning board, he'd have to go to the zoning board to get the variances, you're not supposed to put blinders on and say, oh, we can't look at that. We can't look at that, because CECRA says that all of the steps in an action have to be considered, and that they have to be considered whether the agency decision-making relates to the action as a whole or just to a part of it. See, in this case, your decision-making relates just to a part of it, to the subdivision. But nonetheless, even though there's other decision-making, you have to look at those other parts. And that's what CECRA calls segmentation, that you can't cut the case into little pieces and ignore other pieces. The reason that is important for you, I think, is a very practical reason, and that is, if you were to say, okay, we're going to issue a neg deck on this, which I think is wholly inappropriate in this case, you are going to be tying the hands of the zoning board that next sees this case, because the minute, and again, I think this would be a very bad mistake by the planning board to do, but the minute the planning board says, we don't see any potentially significant impacts under, you know, applying CECRA, when he goes into the zoning board, he's going to be waving that around saying, you can't tell me that these variances are going to harm the community, because the lead agency already said we don't see any major significant impacts. So my suggestion to you is to not accept this kind of dogma that, oh, we can't look at what the ZBA does. You have to look at the whole action here. Also, incidentally, there's another policy that you might want to consider that's in Chapter 116, because there's a provision for specific variances with respect to lands that lie, that have a zoning dividing line between them, which I think is kind of interesting. And what it says is, it's got some language about how you control those variances, and what they tell the zoning board to do is, they say, you have the right to grant variances for lots like that, but only to extend the boundary of a district up to 50 feet, but here's the catcher, into the more restrictive district. Okay, so what I'm saying to you is that in your own code, there is a suggestion of a strong policy that the village wants, and that is, if you're monkeying around with a boundary line, they want you to go toward the more restrictive. That's the kind of variance they can grant. So I think it's relevant. I don't think it controls you, but I think it's something that you should think about. I guess what I'm saying is, although you're only looking at this minor subdivision, the buck really stops here with your CEQA review. Also, I want to remind you that this is a type 1 action under CEQA. I know this is the part of the talk where everybody starts going to sleep, but I'm going to say it anyway. It's kind of my trademark. In a type 1 action, the standard is that type 1 actions are actions that CEQA classifies as being more likely to require an environmental impact statement. And therefore, there is a low threshold of proof for you to say you need to do an impact statement. That low threshold can be stated in plain English. What CEQA says is that if there may be significant adverse impacts, not if there will be, not if there'll probably be, not if there'll most certainly be, just if there may be potential significant adverse impacts, then there must be an environmental impact statement. Okay? And the standard for a negative declaration, that's where you say everything's okay, is a higher standard. Because for a negative declaration, you have to make a determination that there will not be potential significant adverse impacts. And if you look at the factors, and what I would like to see or suggest is that this hearing be continued, because I think you're going to need the help of your planner to do an environmental assessment form, which gives you sort of an outline of how to decide if there are impacts. But CEQA has criteria that you're supposed to look at, and I can go through them quickly. I'm almost done, I promise you. One of them is does the plan create a material conflict with the community's plans or goals as they've been officially adopted or approved? And I think that is clear from the record. It's clear from what council was saying about the master plan when he was reading you the statements that said there's no need to change our zoning districts here. So what we're saying is this minor subdivision that calls for a half-acre lot puts R20 setbacks on the other lots, ignores the fact that 60% of it is in an R120 zone, is in material conflict with the zoning code in your comprehensive plan. Also, something that no one has discussed, mentioned, it's been sort of swept under the rug by the applicant, is there going to be an impairment of the character or quality of any historic, architectural, or aesthetic resources? That relates to whether the subdivision plan itself fits into its neighborhood. I've suggested it doesn't. But also, there is a contributing historic house on 550 Hill Street. It's a contributing property in the historic district. And they're kind of blithely talking about, well, we may move it, we may, I don't know what they're going to do with it. To me, when I read, like, we may move it, but we're not decided, I hear going, gone. But that's an aesthetic resource in the village of Southampton. My suggestion would be that the Board of Historic Preservation Architectural Review is an interested agency, possibly an involved agency, a permitting granting agency, because at some point they're going to come in and have to give the okay to do anything like that, to move it. Might be a good idea to get some input from that board. I've never seen any resolution of a problem that was raised about landscaping and drainage of the proposed driveway. This is the rear one that goes into Captain's Neck. Never seen that resolved. And again, this is another question that I would say to the applicant. They owe you an explanation, not you. I'm not saying like they need to apologize. I'm saying they owe an explanation on paper so that your planner can evaluate something other than them just saying, hey, it's A-OK. I think the idea of, you know, downsizing to the size of the smallest lot in the neighborhood is the opposite of the plans and goals of your comprehensive plan and the opposite of the goals of enacting a good minor subdivision that follows zoning code. You don't protect established character as they're required to do. And that's a phrase that Dave Amelita properly quoted in one of his memos. You don't protect established character by selecting the smallest lot you can find and matching it. That's what they've done here. 116-1C says you're supposed to use land for purposes for which it's most appropriate. The zoning designations on this property tell you what the most appropriate uses are. They are 1 acre, they are 3 acre. That doesn't mean you can, you know, hang a curtain up on that boundary line and say, ignore everything to the right of the curtain. This half of this, more than half of this, two-thirds of this lot's in R120. Section 116-1H says that you're supposed to avoid overcrowding of land and buildings and avoid undue concentration of buildings. When you use R60 dimensional setbacks on your lots to demonstrate what you can build there, you're overcrowding, you're putting too much there, and you're using the wrong setbacks. That they have done. So to me, logic and common sense suggest that what should be going on here is they should be attempting to make the plan as conforming as possible, not copying the worst of planning, the most non-conforming. So I don't think you're, I do think there's an adequate record to deny this, actually. I think it's adequate and legal to deny it. In the alternative, I think I would hope you would request some more information from the applicant, get an update from your planner, hopefully give us a chance to talk again at maybe a continuation of the hearing. But in any event, based on what we know about what they want to do here, I can't see logically any way, if you were going to continue this case as a secret case, to do anything other than issue a positive declaration and say, give it to us in an environmental impact statement, we'll look it over and decide. So I really think you're between those two alternatives, a denial or a pos deck. I think you need more information. Anyway, I know I've taken a little longer than usual, but I have waited a long time, so I appreciate your attention. Unless there are any questions.
Jeff, could we revisit the comment on the historic house? You referred to 550?
Yeah.
It's been so long, I can't remember, but I know there was an issue with one of the buildings as being historic, and it was determined that it was not a contributing asset in that.
You know, I hear that all the time.
Is that 550 or is that the other one?
I hear that. It may be the other one, but I can tell you, dollars to donuts, undoubtedly, no question, I have the materials with me.
You have the blue sheet.
The house at 550 is a contributing historic property. It has a name. It's from the 1850s. Yeah. And it is a beautiful little house. And you know what? I'm going to put in a plug. It's maybe slightly out of range, but you should do everything you can to save that house.
Are you sure?
I'm positive. I have the materials. Mm-hmm. I've talked to the Department of Parks, Recreation and Historic Preservation.
But I know we had received a comment from them, and then it was investigated. This had been in front of the ARB a couple of years ago, and I know there was a determination or some kind of resolution by Zach Studenworth, the consultant, that whatever house was involved was not a contributing asset.
That is wrong.
Did he say that, or did he have the wrong house?
It's wrong for the house at 550 Hill Street. Now, I know there's another house on 5, whatever the other lot is,
54?
54. That house I don't know anything about, but the house on 550 is a contributing property in the historic district.
Thank you.
Mr. Amy.
Mr. Chairman, I have to change a battery.
Great.
One moment.
Okay.
Charlie, good to go?
I
think Mr. Amory has stepped out for a moment, so.
Well, why don't we do this, call up number one on the subject review.
We're going to momentarily pause 5:50 and 5:54.
As Mona's coming back.
Here he comes.
Hold one second, because Linda's going to go first, I think. Okay, I think, right?
Yeah.
We were going to just quickly do that.
All right.
There's a matter of 390 and 410 Ox Pasture Road, which was approved, what?
1983, we were pushed.
And is now showing as a subdivision on the tax map, but had never actually been signed the separate determination?
No, yeah, what it this board approved it in 1982, the subdivision, but did not adopt a SECRA determination. It was right around the time that SECRA came out. And it's now become relevant because the applicant who created the subdivision also did not get Department of Health approval. Again, that was right around the time that the Health Department acquired jurisdiction over these maps. So we have to go back to the Health Department to get the approval now, these decades later. And they demand that the village adopts the SECRA determination. So,
as a matter of really just of bookkeeping, we prepared a negative declaration.
Mm-hmm.
And it's your recommendation that we vote to approve this negative declaration.
Yes.
So moved.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. And I'm adjourning the other thing on the agenda.
Okay.
Which other thing?
AME.
The AME. The AME? Okay.
Oh, that one.
I'm still before the zoning board.
Okay, great.
Mr. Amy.
I don't want to be here all night.
I'm not a lawyer, so I should take a little less time. My name is Minot Amory. I live at 538 Hill Street, right next to the disaster area. My neighbor has started out, originally we started out saying it's going to be a family compound, which is going on and on and on. And if you're looking about the little house next door, I've made many pitches to try to buy that, you know, just to add on to my property. I mean, to put a million little houses up there that this guy's gonna do, it's gonna ruin everything. And plus, I don't wanna hear, you know, screaming cars and children, and you say millions of little outhouses everywhere on the property. I don't need that. I think some of you guys all have been to my house. I just think, just get rid of the thing, should be just closed. If you're gonna do it, do two lots and call it a day.
Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Further comment?
Okay. I'll be brief. Dave Emolito will speak for a minute after I finish. We've separated the issues. I have seven discrete points that I'd like to make. One, I don't have a copy of David Egan's list of variances, so I will foil tomorrow that document, and I'd ask that this matter be restored to your next calendar if that's convenient to you, so that I can address that particular document. I didn't receive a copy of it. The second is that the elimination of an industrial use in any residential zone, would be consistent with any zoning code and any master plan. But it's better than that here. And the reason is, if you will look, and you're gonna need a note to make a note here, Kathy, you're gonna wanna make a note. If you're gonna look at page 84 of the comprehensive plan, future land use plan, figure 37 on page 84, you will find that the master plan of the Village of Southampton calls for the elimination of this industrial use and its conversion to residential use. So all of
this names
yes,
the specific
this
place, right?
Yes, this parcel right here, yes. And so all of those statements were completely erroneous, as a matter of fact, and the only way you're gonna know that is if you take a look at page 84 of the future land use plan and take a look in particular at figure 37. We have two lots. We have two lots. If we remain two lots, then the non-conforming industrial use continues with all the potential that that might have. I'm not sure that makes great planning outcome. access. There are today, this evening, 45 driveways on Captain's Neck Lane. So that when you were told another driveway is not good planning and is hard to justify, is not the way we do things in Southampton, 2 points. One, there are 45 driveways on that street right now. The addition of one more, I guess somebody could get up here and argue just about anything, but I don't know how far they're going to get with that argument.
Tony, you know how many are flag lots?
Well, how about right next door, Ruttenberg? Ruttenberg, one driveway serving four parcels, three houses and a vacant lot, immediately adjacent and contiguous to the driveway that we're talking about tonight.
A flag lot going into lot, as I understand, maybe I got the wrong definition, is a road that goes into a parcel. That's
right. There's nothing wrong with the design of this subdivision in terms of flag lot. There's nothing wrong with flag lots.
Just a question of the 45 driveways.
Yes. Oh, I can't tell you how many are flag lots. No.
How many do you think? How many dollars are flag lots?
I don't know. It wouldn't make a difference. The point is, we're talking about points of access. Another car coming and going, another family living there.
Is a flag lot different than a right away?
No.
Over someone's land? Come on. I think there's a real difference, but I don't know what it is.
The zoning and land use.
You're my land use authority.
I know that.
Best
I know that.
But what's the difference?
There is no language in land use of a right of way. In other words, you don't approve rights of way here. You approve access points. Both on a town level and on a village level. And there's a state requirement, and it's measured by whether or not there's all weather, all year-round access for emergency vehicles, ambulances, about which you heard a lot tonight, police cars and fire trucks. That's
planning,
the measure.
There's no difference between the lot owning the right-of-way and it being owned by some other property.
Nor is there any difference between the ownership in A and the ownership in B. So when you were challenged that Jim Zahusky might own the fee title to the easement way from Captain's Neck to that lot behind his house, that's not anything that neither a zoning board nor a village board of planning board has anything to do with the identity of the owner. And it's fundamental land use.
We're dealing with the I'm just trying to get at the consequences. That's all.
It's an access to a lot, period.
There are several consequences. We'll get to that more.
All right, but it's an access to a lot. That's all that's going on here.
Okay.
Rezoning, sending this to the trustees. You weren't exactly made perfectly clear as to why this would go to the trustees, but the message that you're getting is that it would be rezoned. Well, the problem is you can't rezone that industrial building away. If you're going to do that, then you'd have to adopt an amortization schedule. This village is not prepared to adopt an amortization schedule for that industrial use. And so therefore, sending it to the trustees is a senseless suggestion and sort of mean to you, because you might think that there's actually some basis for sending it to the trustees. There's none at all. It's just words. The next point, we talked about the flag lots. I'm going to turn the mic over to David. He's going to continue with certain other points, and I'm happy to answer questions if you have any.
For the record, David, I'm a lead environmental planning consultant for this application. Tony has covered a few of the points that I was going to cover. but let me state that the EAF Part 1 has been updated, and it has been in your files, I believe, since December of last year. We also have an updated EAF addendum that was dated November 30th, 2015, following an addendum dated October 26, 2013, in which we address all of the points that are required to be addressed in a standard EAF Part 1. And I remember at least one standing up here at the podium before you going over them item by item by item. And I believe we covered every single one of the points, with the exception being the historical contributing status of 550 Hill Street. And that was answered in May of this year by the village's own historic consultant, Zach Studenroth, in which he concluded that 550 Hill Street is not a contributing structure at all and has no no historic benefit to the village's historic district because it was not included in 1986 inventory. It was not included in any of the subsequent updates of that inventory by the village itself, and therefore, Mr. Studenroth, in his own analysis of the structure, its modifications over time render it a non-contributing structure. So the only potential unopened question is to bring that information back to New York State Department of OPR, Office of Parks and Recreation, and therein lies the proof, because they could not, in my several phone calls to them, document why they felt that this was a contributing structure when the village itself never entered into the inventory. So therefore, no impact on the historic district, and that's the only reason why initially this is a type one action, is because it's located within the historic district, but there's no contributing structure. So it's a moot point that it's a type one. All that means is you fill out a long EAF. It has nothing to do with an environmental impact statement being prepared at all. You haven't reached that point yet. So maybe I'm getting a little hot on the collar, but I've heard this stuff so many times. It's almost insulting that some folks who have the knowledge of CEQA are trying to buffalo you into a pos deck when there simply is no basis for one. We have gone through this list, as I said, at least once, probably twice, and we're dealing with, not with a rezoning, we're not dealing with subdivision of a vacant piece of land, we're dealing with the elimination of a non-conforming use. That sets in a whole new perspective. It's a balancing act of eliminating a non-conforming use and protecting or even enhancing the quality of the neighborhood by the elimination of that use. So we certainly couldn't do the opposite. We certainly couldn't, if this warehouse was such a great thing, we certainly couldn't introduce it into the neighborhood at this point now, thinking that, a moving and storage company will be a real benefit to this neighborhood. Come on, folks, we're going in the right direction. The applicant's going in the right direction. Some of the speakers before us would have us have this eyesore, this noise-making facility. Go in there today. I went in there today. I drove around in there today. Does anyone think that what's going on there is a benefit to the adjacent residences? It's a pre-existing non-conforming use. It can continue forever exactly the way it is. If the applicant doesn't, I would put it so bluntly as to say, gets what he wants, but he has modified his proposal from 4 lots to 3. There are 3 uses there now, 2 residences and industrial use. We're simply asking for 3 residences to change a non-conforming use into a conforming use. You can argue, or it can be considered, the lot sizes, the dimensions as a result, but in the long run, does that create an adverse environmental impact on a neighborhood? It's a change in the numbers, fine. In 1983, when the R40 and R120 zoning district line was created, and the whole village went through a rezoning in 1983, you have to remember, accurate tax maps did not exist then. I was around, I know that. They did not exist then. No one really knew where all the property lines went. If we were today, we're going to go through that process and redefine or define the R40 and R120 district, we wouldn't put that boundary where it is. We're stuck with it. So this configuration, again, is a balancing act. Is it such a big deal? You know, you can make a mountain out of a molehill, but I don't think it's that big a deal.
Living next to it is.
That question should be addressed to the board at the proper time. The major benefit, as I see it, or one of the major benefits, is a reduction in traffic, not an increase in traffic. if you do the math, by all existing trip generation manuals, there will be a reduction of 37 trips per day as a result of the proposed use versus the current configuration of uses. And the the distribution of that traffic is not all on Hill Street. I don't know exactly how many big scale tractor trailers back up and do the K-turn on Hill Street anymore, because the active moving and storage business isn't there. But there's certainly a lot of other trucks and trailers and equipment and materials being stored on that site, and all that traffic is still ongoing, but would be eliminated entirely from the neighborhood if the subdivision is granted. I did take copious notes on everything the other speakers addressed, but if you have any further questions, I'd be happy to try to address them.
David, do you have a copy of Zach's report?
I do, and you should, but I will make sure. Yeah, and I will make sure you get one. Okay,
David.
Both the file.
I know firsthand you have a long and illustrious history at this, as does Tony, who always gives me lots of Supreme Court cases I have to go read and everything else. And Gil tells me he's never heard of it before, even if it might have happened. But the historic map goes out of its way to include this entire property in that historic district, which I don't really care about. It's not our business. I got to ask Kathy, I guess, to go do some research on this. Okay, so what's going on here? There is presently, we get lots of other information, as you know, which ultimately we have to, there's a huge movement underway in the village now. Testimony from adventurers and people testifying. John Bennett's here, who knows a lot about this, to say anything commercial. And I'm going to, we can fight about industrial versus commercial versus, you know, do with business. The argument is now going in this village before the ARB that anything commercial on Hill Street is ipso facto by its face worthy of preservation, literally at all costs. Because when it was called the Shinnecock Road, and it was the Route 39 into this village, those businesses marked the entrance into the village. So they, you remember Thompson's plumbing thing, all that sort of stuff. Those changes, some were over, done away with, the Irving House and stuff, but anything that's left really needs to be preserved to preserve the history. So I don't know what we do. We may not be the ARB. I don't know who's going to do this. So maybe Kathy has to talk to Zachary. I don't know where they are in this thing, because their locations right there, within a few hundred yards of that place, where the arguments are being, oh, you've got to keep them, just to the neighborhood. I've told these people before, I tried to find out what the history was of because I know a lot of the neighbors. I know people who rented there and lived there and everything else. They've called me up. There was a lot of discussion, again, because of a conflict, I guess, with the zoning board in front of the ARB 10, 11 years ago. The discussion came from neighbors saying the house on Captain's Neck, next to this place, that was the largest one as you come down. They start to get a lot larger after the first three, I think, as you come up on the east side of Captain's Neck. That house, when it was being built, wanted to build it, they said they were going to build it as far to the north as they possibly could and create maximum space on the south, which is where the road will go in, I guess, if there's a road or some type goes in for the back lot. Neighbors objected. The hearings went on for about 7 months from what I can tell. And when I say what I can tell is, for reasons known to the world from 10 years ago, no file exists on that house. It has been lost in the movements of village authorities. There's no building file. There is no architectural review file. Review board's secretary stopped her. They had a wonderful lady doing it. She terminated her job in the middle of this and disappeared. And even the CTV record Charlie's the expert. He and I have worked on this forever under the FUTA thing to find out what the movies might say. But there's missing the hearing at which the applicant, over objections from the ARB and everybody else, simply went ahead and did what was initially proposed. No change. And I've had people who were on the Kathy Bellows board from back then. You were in charge of things in those days. You may remember all this. People were coming in. Mr. Ruttenberg had brought his place. He said, they're just going to put a road in there. And if you look at the old maps, there's a dip there. The dip was a wing of Hetty Creek that ran in what is really sort of the back of the, it came across what's now Lee Avenue down at the bottom, and it sort of terminates right there. So there's about a, from sort of the plane of that house to the road, and it goes lower on Mr. Ruttenberg's property. It's about a 7-foot drop, and I've been there many times. Gil got a survey. It shows it's 6.5, you know, whatever it is. So there's a real issue to driving a road along there. It's in the bottom of what has been filled in. It goes under Ray Floyd's house, and they filled it in. It comes in there, and dead ends right there. So they're mechanical issues. What are you going to do? I like Captain's Neck Lane. I've been on it many times. I even spent a honeymoon at the bottom of Captain's Neck Lane on one of, I think, there are only 3 flag lots.
We don't need the details.
Owned or otherwise, okay? So I've known it for years. I think there are only 3 on the whole road. So we're going to start to open it up, flag lots and stuff. We built Mary Lee Drive to solve one of the problems.
Yeah.
So we've been at this before.
Yes.
So from a planning point of view, which may address the balancing of all, nothing's ever black and white, all the balancing of this, I'd love to find out. Kathy has to do this, I guess. What does Zach think about this? Because he's now facing new initiatives under the ARB thing. If it's not our business, fine, I'm delighted to let somebody else deal with it. You're really good at that. You've done it many times for a lot of people, including myself. We know all about that. We all have to get that resolved, I think, under the current circumstances. And whether it's commercial or not commercial, I agree moving vans are different than the utility vehicles that seem to be harvested there mostly. Hey, we have to get the facts. And the zoning seems to say, however you do the math, the only question is, are there 2 lots or 3 lots? Do they come off Hill Street, or do we deal with Captain's Neck Lane? Real simple. Because I don't think it's likely to stay forever as a truck parking lot, a local right now, construction or supporting parking lot instead of a storage area. So if we're going to, the right thing is supposed to happen for balance for everybody. I think we need to solve this mushroom cloud of history. I'd love to solve this thing off Captain's Neck, particularly that spot. That's the dip. It's the back of the Knight's dip. And that filled in, it used to run through the Knight property. It's a mess over there. And it goes through there. And so it'd be nice to do it right for the village. And add into Hill Street, if it gets better, it'd be fine. But it'd be nice to do it.
You've raised a handful of issues.
That's okay. That comes to
yes,
people
yes.
talk to us. We get people to tell
yes.
us it's in the submissions.
Throughout the village, or throughout the western half of the village at least, there are a number of swales that run northeast to southwest toward Hetty Creek and Taylor Creek.
Yep.
And they do have different degrees of impact on individual properties.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in this case, and this also gets to the point tangentially of your question of a right-of-way versus a flag lot. Flag lot is one lot. Right-of-way may serve more than one lot, but this right-of-way will only serve one lot. So it's a distinction without a difference. It's just one lot.
Who controls the road in from the road to the lot?
Yeah, but just to that one
fix
lot.
It, repair it and run it. You'd probably have to build a 6 or 7 foot wall.
Well, I don't know about it. A retaining wall might solve it. I don't know. Some amount of fill might solve it. That could be. I don't want to write your decision for you, and I don't want to suggest. And I'm maybe out of bounds by saying this, but it might pay to have a site plan review on the individual lot. And I'm probably way out of bounds by suggesting that in a public forum.
He's not here. Tony's covered. We ask Gil. We got some topo map that was a few feet here or there.
Yeah.
But you need a solution. It's probably a wall to cover the fill. I don't know how long it's going to be.
Yeah.
That's not my job.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It seems
okay.
to me, if you
well,
use it,
it's a legitimate
that's
issue.
That's a burden.
It's a legitimate issue.
Yeah.
Now, as far as you two are talking about the we'll call them the missing documents, is that 62 Captain's Neck you're referring
yep.
to?
If you can find
ABJ LLC? No. I don't want to, again, we're in a public forum. I don't want to.
Charlie can't find them. We've been through all the records. It's all missing. And what was the few things you can see on CTV, approximately five neighbors came in and registered strong objections to that house not being in the middle of the lot, and with an eye to the fact that the bottom was being set up for access to the moving area. And I guess everybody ignored it. I wasn't there.
Yeah.
But the people that were there have come and complained to me on the board. Said, Jesus, you can't believe what happened.
You know, one can't judge the motives of an owner positioning his dwelling and accessory structures on a lot.
But it raised the issue of the lot into the moving area. It's been before the village before.
If it got a building permit, it had to have complied. That's all I can say.
I couldn't agree with you.
Okay.
You got a building permit.
Okay. Okay.
Absolutely.
And if it opened up or left open the opportunity for that to happen, in the owner's mind, that's okay too.
Absolutely.
Okay.
But
so
now it's before us.
Okay. Understood. Now, if it left some unresolved issues, and there may be some, then I think in my own mind, as a professional planner, land use planner, I think it's worthy of a harder look, of a greater look. But does it merit a positive declaration? Does it merit an environmental impact statement? Come on, folks.
We'll get to that later. But as you just said, those issues are back in front of us again, and we have to deal with them somehow.
Okay.
It's not our burden.
Fair enough.
Gil's the head man. He's got to come get it before us, because that's what the code says has got to be resolved.
Okay. Well, clearly, we're not closing the hearing tonight. We have more issues to look at, and I'm glad to have finally heard from the neighbors to see where they're coming from and the depth of their analysis and understanding of the whole thing, and we'll deal with it all. We'll deal with it all.
And it may be zero, but somebody has to tell us, because we get the stuff that says these issues are right around us and they're viewed as important for Shinnecock Road.
Getting back to that question, is it sentimentality versus historic significance? Where do you draw the line? I mean, we have seen a lot of what I thought were decent little pre-existing non-conforming businesses on Hill Street in my lifetime.
Yep.
And one by one, they've all ticked away, and we see the last two or three probably going to disappear, except for one maybe on the very end.
It's become residential.
And
I agree.
You know,
but people in the village are taking a contrary view, and we have to deal with it. I agree. Listen, I've lived on both of the swales, both Taylor and Hedy Swale. I've lived on the water table. I can tell when you drill, I can find the water table here. Tell me which month.
Yeah.
It's an issue. You know that.
Yes.
It just depends which month you drill.
Yeah.
Just how far down you go.
So
we need, that's the burden.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. I don't want to belabor this anymore, but
do you have anything else to address tonight?
Good afternoon. Good evening. David Kirst of Egan Matthews again. Here with my colleague David Egan for PHB Realty. I'll be very quick. Specifically, in regards to the reference made by counsel for the applicant regarding the inclusion of this property in a figure or list in the master plan, I think is a bit of a stretch. The figure he refers to is simply a map of the entire village of future land use, showing all residential properties used for residences, all commercial properties used commercially, and all parks and recreation highway business. There's no specific reference in the master plan to this individual property, the elimination of this use. If you go to page 25, there's a specific list of the Rambo site, of the village business center, of a cluster of bed and breakfast. There's no specific reference to this site at all in the master plan. So I just wanted to make that clear. I'm sure you would have reviewed it the same yourself, but thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Amelita.
Thank you. Direct rebuttal to that assertion. I have
I'll show you, this is a photocopy of the page in the comprehensive plan.
If you give it to Kathy, then Kathy can reach up here.
And it clearly shows the this property in the future land use plan as residential. You see it outlined in red.
We just need the data.
Really close, perfect argument.
So are.
What they're saying is that this is a subject parcel.
Kathy, can I clarify one thing?
Future plan.
As I recall the history of this application before us, they presented the EAF for the four lot subdivision.
Right.
And then there were some issues with that, and the applicant said, oh, hold everything, we are going to come back with a better revised plan. And it took them several months to do that, and finally this plan came back.
Right.
But never have we addressed any, the EAF has never been addressed again.
Right.
To my memory.
That's right, yeah.
So.
So, yeah, absolutely, we will need to do a part two and determine the part three. Yeah, they've done an expanded EAF, which is generally the part three, and to determine whether the part three is adequate. So, yeah, we haven't done that yet.
Right.
This time.
I just wanted to clarify on the map, it does show future land use of that property as residential, as it does for every other residence. It's not a specific reference to eliminating this moving and storage use, changing the use on this property. It's a general map of the entire village. All right, thank you very much.
So we, the applicant requests an adjournment to the next meeting.
Thank you.
So moved.
At the request of the applicant, adjourn the 550-551 Hill Street until the Monday, June 6th regular meeting.
For all purposes.
For all purposes.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. After those contentious issues, we now have a tennis court.
In the file is a decision approving the tennis court as submitted. An affirmative vote on the motion will be to approve the court. So moved.
All in favor of approving the Halsey Farm Moat LLC tennis court?
Aye.
Aye.
I think it was more south.
Okay.
I think that was more south.
Now we have.
Oh, that one was more south, right?
Yep. Yes, ish. Yes.
Yeah,
north, south, ish.
Pending decision for OIA Associates.
In the file is a decision approving the site plan and the subdivision, two approvals, two applications. Affirmative votes on both of them will be to approve the site plan and the subdivision. Yeah. So moved.
OIA,
so moved.
All in favor of the affirmative decision?
Aye.
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 Thank you. Harkonnen LLC and the Treaties LLC 408 Forest First Neck Lane.
A decision in the file approving the final subdivision conditionally upon the submission by the owners of a mutually acceptable covenant and approval of the health department.
We have health department.
All right. It's not shown on the map.
But we'll get it. So it says that it's okay to make a condition because we have it. That's fine.
Right. And an affirmative vote on the application will be to approve the subdivision. So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 I had trouble.
One of you for a copy of each of those.
Thank you, Mr. Lansky.
And then the other one as well.
It's a covenant.
Here's OIA.
Well, it's a covenant that gets recorded. It's a covenant that gets recorded and all that. So everybody.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.
It's a covenant, Alan, but this is a particular, the determination is it has no effect on the general health, safety, and welfare of the village. It's between the two.
But the
owners.
Covenant is in, everybody agreed on the covenant. It goes with the land. When you and I are in heaven, people know this was done.
It goes with the land.
Yeah, yeah, it'll be
thank you.
He's going to heaven.
Well, you know, some days are better than others.
Margaret H. Fowler, 550 Woodcup Park Road, and 35 and 83 Fowler Street.
Good night.
Yeah.
Where are we on that?
We want to schedule a public hearing for this one. This is for a final subdivision.
Okay. Make a motion to adjourn for a public hearing, Margaret Fowler, 555 with the Wicca Park, to the June 6th meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
A lot line modification for Donahue and Silvets at 42 and 38 Post Crossing.
Anybody here on that application?
So we'll adjourn that?
Yeah.
Make a motion at the request of the applicant to adjourn for all purposes the Donahue Silvets 42 and 32 Post Crossing application.
Yeah, review it, you review it.
So I have a second?
Second, Matt.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Ian Fife, 45.
Well, let me do a official.
AAME, we adjourn.
It was a request that we, yeah. Make a motion at the request of the applicant to adjourn the AAMEE until the June 6th meeting.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Ian Fife's 45 Hampton Road apparently approved his request at the ARP.
There's a decision in the file approving the application predicated upon the approval of the site plan by the Board of Architectural Review. An affirmative vote on the motion will be to approve the application.
So moved.
Seconded.
Aye. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
This bike is a pain.
Sorry about that.
All right. Oh, good.
And last but not least, Drew Schuttinger, 157 White Street. Public hearing to be scheduled for the landscape review for the flag lot.
Make a motion at the request of the applicant to adjourn for a public hearing the Drew Schuttinger, 157 White Street application to the June 6th meeting.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. To schedule a public hearing.
Has everyone had the chance to review the minutes from March 7th and March 28th?
I haven't, but I promise I'll have another work session.
Ward wasn't here, so.
I forget who was in.
Do you want to approve them? Because we have three who would approve them if you didn't. Do you want to read them? Or?
I'd rather
read
them.
So we'll delay that to the work session, the approval of those minutes.
Okay.
The next meeting is Tuesday, May 31st, which is changed from Monday due to Memorial Day. That is a work session. The next public meeting is June, and that would be at 5 p.m. on May 31st. The next session would be June 6th at 5:30. With that said, if there's no further business, we have a motion to close the meeting.
So moved.
Bro, do you have, I don't have the original on John Bennett's thing. There's only OIA? A copy.
It was in there when I gave it, so I don't know what happened to it.
I've got the two files here, and there's just a copy sitting there.
Well,
do I have a second to close the meeting?
Yes, well, you bet. You seconded. As you made
all in favor of closing the meeting?
Aye.
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 Steve?